welcome to the first game of the 1978 American League Championship Series. From Royal Stadium, the Yankees meet the Kansas City Royals. Participating advertisers are the Miller Brewing Company, brewers of light beer, everything you've always wanted in a beer and less.
Well,
hello again, everybody, and welcome to Kansas City, Missouri. I'm Bill White, along with Frank Messer. And tonight, the Yankees and the Kansas City Royals, Frank, meet for the third straight time in the 1978, at least this is the 1978 American League Championship Series. The Yankees, of course, triumphant in the first two and hoping to do the same here in this series.
Well, I'll tell you, Bill, if the first two series between these clubs is any indication, it's going to go five games and go down to the final out of the final game to decide a winner, because that's the way it's been the last two times. And another thing we think about, if tonight's game and this series is similar to Yankee-Kansas City play during the regular series, we'll see some high-scoring ball games, because in the 11 games they played this year, these two clubs scored a total of 103 runs, 52 by Kansas City, 51 by the Yankees. And right now, the teams are lined up down on the playing field. And I don't know, Bill, it's whatever happens tonight, nothing, I don't think, that we'll ever see in baseball will be much more symbolic or traditional or hair-raising as yesterday's game between the Yankees and the Boston Red Sox.
Quite an exciting game, Frank. The Yankees winning that ball game 5-4, and the Red Sox certainly have nothing to be ashamed of as we look at the Yankees now being introduced individually. Most of the club, except for the starting team, has already been introduced. But, you know, the Red Sox really have nothing at all to be ashamed of. They fought the Yankees all the way down to the wire, and I think Red Sox fans have certainly got to be as proud of their ball club as I'm sure Yankee fans are proud of the New York Yankees.
That's very true, Bill. Both teams were winners. I'll tell you, the Yankees had to go to the 100th win to get the Eastern Division. Any team like the Red Sox to win 99 and lose 63 ball games is certainly a winning ball club. And I think all over baseball, fans are doffing their caps and congratulating both the winners and the losers yesterday. Just a great game, and you couldn't ask for any more in baseball.
Well, right now, those two clubs, the Yankees and Boston, have the best records in all of baseball. Kansas City won the Western Division of the American League with 92 wins and 70 losses. Philadelphia won the Eastern Division of the National League with 90 wins and 72 losses. The Dodgers won 95 and lost 67, so the Yankees with 100 wins, 63 losses. Boston with 99 and 64, they had the best records in all of baseball.
And just by a quirk of geography, they both had to be in the same division, and that's a little bit of a shame. But that was yesterday, and now the Yankees and the Royals look forward to this series. The winner, best three wins out of five in this series, to take on either the Philadelphia Phillies or the Los Angeles Dodgers, who begin their championship series tomorrow night.
Well, tonight the Yankees will use rookie right-hander Jim Beatty. Beatty's won six and lost nine so far this year, and the Kansas City Royals will counter with the New Yorker Denny Leonard from Miona College. Denny Leonard has won 21 and lost 17 so far this year for the Kansas City Royals. It's Al Cowan's going out as the Royals are now being introduced.
Frank White.
The Royals, if anything, would have a little bit of an edge in starting pitching, perhaps in this series, with Dennis Leonard, considered to be the ace of their staff, able to go in at least two games tonight, and he could come back again in the series. The Yankees' number one pitcher, Ron Guidry, who pitched yesterday, would be able to make only one appearance in this championship series. So a little bit of an edge, perhaps, to Kansas City in starting pitching.
Well, we got a great break yesterday. By them finishing the tie with Boston, of course, we got a tremendous break. The fact that Guidry couldn't pitch against us tonight with a complete 4 days rest. And I know they had to shoot the works yesterday. They had to use Guidry. They had to use Gossage. And, you play a five-game series, and we'd have to face the best pitcher in baseball two times. This year, we only have to face him one time, and that's certainly a break to us. And it is an advantage to us. It hurt the Yankees by having to have that playoff game, but we still have to go out and beat them. And as I look at the Yankee ball club, the fact that they are world champions, they added Rich Gossage last year, who I consider the finest relief pitcher in baseball, and I'm not trying to take anything away from Raleigh Fingers or anybody like that, but he's just an overpowering guy, and he can put a game away if he comes in with the bases loaded in the eighth and ninth inning. So there's 75 other wins there besides Mr. Guidry, so we got to hope that we can beat the other guys, and when we do face Mr. Guidry, take care of him too.
Some comments of Kansas City manager Whitey Herzog just a short time ago as his team had concluded their batting and were going into the clubhouse for their final meeting before they pulled the helmets on tight and came out to take on the Yankees. Dennis Leonard, the right-hander who is pitching for Kansas City in this opening game, coming off the regular season with a record of 21-17, is probably one of the more deliberate people in all of baseball in preparing for a game. He has not concluded his warm-ups, and the game is going to be delayed just a few minutes until Kansas City Royals for you defensively, and there is a new name in left field, Steve Braun, who came over from the Seattle Mariners in the trade for pitcher Jim Colburn. He's out there, I'm sure, delighted that he's involved in a championship series. In center field, as Jim Palmer said, one of the best in the business at that position, Amos Otis, who's had a tremendous season. Over in right field, it is a fellow named Al Cowens, who has a very good arm and almost never misses his relay man. Very good defensive player when he is healthy. At third base, just a great big old country boy that loves to chew tobacco and play baseball. One of the best around at his position, George Brett, who can be double poison when he's hot. Freddie Patek, looking a little bit different now that he's decided to grow a little bit around his cheeks. He's had a sore shoulder, but he is healthy and says he feels good going into the series. At second base, an outstanding athlete for Kansas City, Frank White, who covers an awful lot of territory in the middle of the infield. Over at first base, it is Pete LeCocq, another fellow who can swing a hot bat, and when he's got it going, he can really damage you. Pete LeCocq at first base. He's alternated there with John Wuffen. Back of the plate is the guy who literally carried this ball club when it was stumbling and staggering in the middle of the season, Daryl Porter. He's had a great year, and on the mound, the big right-hander, Dennis Leonard. Leonard getting his slow start during the process of the season in order to stop overthrowing and releasing too early in his delivery at the suggestion of the pitching coach Galen Sisco. Settled down to three-quarter speed, but Jim, even when this big right-hander has it going three-quarter, it is authoritative. Now the batting order for the Yankees. Rivers will lead it off. Thurman Munson continues to hit in the number two position in the absence of Willie Randolph. Lou Piniella will be hitting third. Reggie Jackson, the designated hitter in cleanup. Greg Nettles will be hitting in the number five spot, followed by Chris Chambliss, the first baseman. Roy White will be hitting left-handed. He's a switch hitter against the right-hander Leonard. Brian Doyle will be playing at second base in the absence of Randolph, and it could be that we might see Fred Stanley move into that spot if changes have to be made later. And then the shortstop, Bucky Dent. And I suspect that Bucky Dent will come to the plate tonight wearing that little ankle guard that we had seen him wear earlier in the season. I know that he put it on tonight when he went to the batting cage to take batting practice. Yesterday, didn't have it on. Almost hurt himself enough to the point we had to come out of the ballpark, but then slapped that three-run home run on the very next pitch. Says his ankle is very sore. Mickey Rivers stands in. The ball game is about ready to begin, with Lou DiMuro back at the plate to call the balls and strikes. Rivers in at 265 with 11 home runs and 48 runs batted in, and we're underway. And a swing and a miss.
Nick the Quick, that's what they call him in New York. It's been said a billion times. He makes the club go. Not alone, though. Randolph usually with him.
Changed on it, missed with it, and it's one and one as Brett is well off the line at third and in close at third base. Just didn't want to tempt Mickey too much to roll the ball out in that direction, because he is a good bunter. He's now two and one.
It is very hard as we look at George Brett to walk Mickey Rivers. He's an unorthodox hitter. He'll swing at anything, won't he, Jim?
Yes, he will. Over his head, in the ground.
That's fouled off.
I asked Dennis how he's going to pitch to Mickey, and we in Baltimore try to throw him a lot of curveballs, and I suggested that, and he said the last time he threw him a curveball, he hit it over the right field fence for a home run. So looks like he's staying with the fastball.
Rivers leading off for New York, top of the first inning from Kansas City. First two games are here, then they move to New York. The ball is hit in the air to left field for Braun. One out. So the newest member of the Kansas City Royals regular unit, Steve Braun, has the pleasure of the first put out. Now it is Thurman Munson at 297. Six home runs and 71 runs batted in. Not exactly a Munson-like year.
No, not in terms of power or RBIs, but he's been plagued all year by injuries, and he's not a well man right now. What he is a professional.
And there's a strike.
Batting second is not new to him. That's happened to him before in his Yankee career. It does take away something from him in terms of power ability. If there's a man on, he must try to move him along.
Holds on it. They check at first base. Rich Garcia says no. It's one and one with one out and nobody on for the Yankees at the top of the first. The wind is fresh toward right field. Punch foul.
Jim Munson says one reason he likes batting second is he finds himself, because he may have more to do in different situations up there, more bat manipulation, it helps him because he concentrates more on the pitcher.
Well, it seems to me that Thurman always concentrates the way he hits us, but he's just a good hitter.
That pitch is high. They are giving him left center. The left fielder, Braun, is well off the line in left. The center fielder, Otis, is well over toward right center. Now, it's in that left center neighborhood that he dumped his double yesterday.
Exactly.
That's hit to the right side. Foul. LeCocq taking a dive at it. Better just get Pete loose.
It was not hit well. And as Keith has indicated, we haven't seen Thurman swinging in the recent days and even weeks with the old Thurman Munson swing, because of the injuries that plague him.
A new baseball for Dennis Leonard. 21 and 17, Bob Lemon in the Yankee dugout. As I mentioned, used to manage at one time here in Kansas City. That ball is hit to right, base hit. Collins plays it on the second hop. Munson is on at first base with the first hit of the ball game.
Bob Lemon, whom you just saw in the Yankee dugout, did indeed bring tranquility to what had been a Yankee tempest or hurricane on a continuing basis. He reminds me of the old saying, may God grant me the serenity to accept the things that I cannot change.
And told me yesterday that in his wildest dreams, couldn't have imagined or fantasized that what would happen to him this year would happen. He's overcome by it when he sits down to think about it a little bit. Now it is Lou Piniella, a 3-14 hitter, and Leonard misses for ball one with Munson on first base. It is artificial surface here at Royal Stadium, and it is very fast. Royals will bunch up on you defensively in the middle of the infield. They play Piniella straight away.
Piniella, of course, a solid 300 hitter who enjoyed his rookie year as a member of a Kansas City team and was indeed at once rookie of the year.
Holding Thurman.
Isn't it surprising that Lou Piniella became a hero as a fielder?
Very much so, Howard. I saw Lou when he first came up, and he was known strictly for his bat, but he's really worked hard, and he's made the great plays the last couple of years.
Fouled away. You've seen Reggie Jackson loosening there in the on-deck circle. Reggie, I guess, still holds the honor of having hit the longest home run ever in this ballpark.
There he is. Somehow with a God-given ability almost to rise to the occasion. No matter the vicissitudes of his baseball life, when the clutch is there, he is there. Your old manager, Earl Weaver, said he's the best October player he ever saw. He's still
Earl's
your
usually
manager.
Right.
I mean, Earl, in terms of years.
One and one pitch fouled away. The crowd came in, filled the stadium, and they did it very quietly. There's been very little noise so far at the ball yard in Kansas City.
Earl's watching tonight. Maybe if he had taken your advice, you'd have been down there, Jim. If they'd gotten you a defensive outfit.
Thanks, Howard. I've already gone through that all year.
1-2 pitch coming to Fenella. Hits it toward White. Bobbles it over to Patek to get Munson. And the fielder's choice with Fenella pulling up at first base. So quick hands, quick reactions by Frank White after that ball came skipping off the artificial surface to get Munson coming down from first base. I told you it was quick. And I think sometimes it appears with a spin on the ball on the first and second hop, it'll accelerate. Here he is. It was his home run with nobody aboard in the eighth inning yesterday in Boston that ultimately proved the difference for the Eastern Division Championship. But when people read the history books 50 years from now, I'm sure the one thing that'll jump out most of all will be that successive home run Benji had last year in the World Series. But when you look at the history of the two playoffs between these two teams, as Reggie takes a strike, you'll have to go back to Game 5 when Reggie Jackson delivered a single that produced the victory, or set up the victory. Otherwise, the Yankees would not have been in the World Series. With two out, Fenella at first, Jackson swings and misses, and it's two strikes.
That was an interesting pitch to go after.
I think he got through it, Howard. Dennis Leonard has one of the best curveballs in the league. And he just swung at a ball in the dirt. Must have thought it was a fastball.
This is a ball club, Jim, and it seemed to me that you must stay ahead of the middle of the order.
Definitely. You just can't get behind the Yankee hitters and throw them fastballs and get them out.
Two-strike pitch is hit up the middle. Otis will play it on the bounce. Almost ricochets over his head. Bobbles it. Fenella goes to third. Jackson in the second. And Fenella turns and holds at third.
Now that's an evidence of Reggie Jackson at his best when he becomes the complete ball player and not just a designated hitter. Watch the pitch again and the hit again. The point I'm making is the way Jackson took advantage of the bounce almost over Otis's head. Watch that. And immediately set out for second. Otis with a good throwing arm, you're taking a chance. But Jackson forcing the play.
Single for Reggie, error on Otis. Base runners at second and third with two out. The batter is Greg Nettles. Time has been called for a moment by the umpires.
Greg Nettles, the man who kills Jim Palmer. Why, Jim?
I don't know, but Dennis Leonard asked me how I pitched to him for some unknown reason. I said I threw him a lot of curveballs because all the fastballs go out of the ballpark.
High drive, center field. Otis going back. Going back. Against the wall. And Dennis Leonard and Whitey Herzog and all the Kansas City faithful breathe a sigh of relief. After one half inning of play, we have no score. Hyde is in left field to start the ball game. The senior member of the Yankees in center field. It is Mickey Rivers who can cover 40 acres for you out there in right field. It is Lou Fenella. Now moving to the inside, it is Greg Nettles at third base, and a very good one. At shortstop, yesterday's hero, Bucky Dent. Good solid player, Brian Doyle. Subbing for Willie Randolph at second. Steady, Chris Chambliss at first base. Back of the plate doing the catching, Thurman Munson on the mound. 24-year-old Jim Beattie, 6'6", 210-pounder, 1975, number four selection by New York in the free agent draft. And his first pitch to Steve Braun is ball one.
I'm interested, Keith, in how much of the line Nettles is giving Steve Braun, who's known to be an inside-out hitter.
You're right, Howard, but I talked to Frank White, and he feels that when you play here, and I'm sure maybe Nettles feels the same way, you have to give him a double down the line. To play on the line would be ridiculous because everybody else is going to hit the ball by you. It goes by you so quickly on the artificial turf.
Made his first strike of the ball game there.
Which is why Kansas City basically defensively here bunches the middle, right?
Exactly.
A 2-1 pitch coming to Braun. Steve takes it high. And right now, Beatty is doing exactly what he told Howard Cosell he did not want to do, and that is get behind. Braun, who came to Kansas City as a bench player to be used as a left-handed pinch hitter and back up at third base, wound up starting in left field, and that pitch just nipped the inside corner, and it's full at 3-2.
Braun is also a bad ball hitter. He likes the ball a little bit below the plate, over the inside half of the plate. You can kill him on the outside.
Pull to the right side. Chambliss flags, can't get it. Beatty covers, throws in time. So the youngster hustled off the mound to get over there and take the throw from Brian Doyle, the second baseman.
As you look at it again, the ball passed Chambliss's outstretched glove, but Beatty was where he's supposed to be as Brian Doyle momentarily had trouble finding the ball for the release.
It's a play you work on every day in spring training for about 40 days, and that's just when it pays off in the playoffs.
And yet, there are people who forget to do it.
That's why we work it on it for 40 days in spring training.
George Brett, 294 hitter. George is going to have some surgery on a thumb that's been bothering him for the better part of the season.
Also other surgery. He's really, he's been having all kinds of physical problems and is still not right. Look at this pitch again, Jim. Thurman seemed a little befuddled.
Well, he's sitting away, and Beatty, it shows how hard Beatty's throwing. He threw the ball inside, and Thurman just got handcuffed.
That's foul back. Got one ball and one strike.
Jim Palmer, of course, with Keith Jackson and yours truly. Only 121 this year, and off year for Jim. Lost 12.
I can do that every year.
Amos Otis is on deck, one out, nobody on. Kansas City, half of the first inning. As Brett swings and got a little bit of it, but Thurman holds on, and it's 1-2. That thumb injury has a bone chip right at the base of the right thumb, and it troubles him some. He also collected a left shoulder separation when he ran into Tim Nordbrook in Milwaukee early in the year.
That's the other problem.
Way inside, and the young right-hander out of Dartmouth College is now at 2-2 on George Brett. Otis, a 298 hitter, waiting on deck. Hit sharply foul down the first base line. Ball boy came up with it cleanly.
Dartmouth College is producing a lot of major league athletes. I don't know if you've noticed the recent influx into the National Football League, Keith. Reggie Williams, linebacker, Cincinnati. Young man named Robinson with the Jets. They're Ivy League will fool you.
Beatty now trying to pace himself a little bit. Gather himself as Brett has come back for a fresh piece of lumber. The hand hurts George more when the pitch is thrown inside or when it completely misses. We saw yesterday what a sore wrist can mean as Carl Yastrzemski struggled through a good portion of the season with it. Hard to stop the bat. Pops him up, foul. Coming back, Munson to the screen, makes the catch.
Good play. Brett told me before the game that the thumb hurt him so it forced him to swing easy. His average fell to 270. But then he said, I made up my mind. It hurts the same way if I swing easy or hard. I began swinging hard, and I feel I ended respectably, getting my average up to 294. Look at the year Otis is in.
Dangerous hitter. Two out and nobody on now for Kansas City.
2 years ago in this very ballpark, in the opening game on his first time up in the first inning, Amos Otis crossing first base damaged his ankle. He was out for the whole series, and certainly that was a factor in the Yankees' victory in that series. This is an exceptional ball player.
Swing and a miss on the first pitch.
You're right, Howard. He's one of the best all-around outfielders in our league. He can hit the ball with power. He can steal a base anytime he wants to. He's really as good as he wants to be.
He hurt his left ankle, as Howard said, and he is so conscious of it and aware of it that he admits consciously trying to hit first base now with his right foot when he goes down there. Takes a long time to shake off a jam like that, and it's once in a while still tender. One strike count on him. Strike two.
They play him in the infield straight away, but they can give him the right field line. If we had the camera on Chambliss, you could see that. On deck is Darryl Porter, whom, as Keith said so aptly earlier, held this team together during the middle part of the season when they were struggling terribly and the Angels appeared as if they might win the thing in the West.
Now we're ready for two-strike pitch. Beatty being quite deliberate. And now Otis steps out on him.
Munson has grown affable, hasn't he?
Yeah.
Good spirits the last 2-3 days. Crowd beginning to pick it up now. And Beatty delivers inside and high for ball one.
Look at Munson's right foot. He's implanted, apparently. I mean, Otis's right foot. He's implanted, apparently, on the line, and it doesn't matter now. He was struck out. Beautiful pitch by Beatty.
Very impressive first inning by the young right-hander, wasn't it? After one inning of play in game number one for the American League title, no score. We move now to the top of the second inning. The Yankees will send to the plate the first baseman, Chris Chambliss, followed by Roy White and then Brian Doyle. 1978 series. Kansas City swept the last three at Yankee Stadium. First time in their history they've been able to do that. And they hit the Yankees right at the time when the turmoil was the greatest. And they came out of there with three. And Dennis Leonard is in with strike one to Chris Chambliss. Chris has been struggling at the plate toward the tail end of the season.
That's right.
Two strikes.
Plays in spurts. Often gets tired and the bat shows it. The bat becomes heavy. So he ended at 274, but has the capacity for the key hit.
Gone on three pitches.
Well, Leonard is throwing a lot more authoritatively now than he was in the first inning when he was lucky to escape. He fired those balls.
I'm sure he feels a lot better, Howard. The first inning is the most difficult inning to go through. You come out of the bullpen, you might have warmed up great. You come to a new mound. You don't know what you have, and all of a sudden you're facing a guy like Mickey Rivers, a guy like Thurman Munson, and all, you just don't know what to do, and it just takes you a while to get into the flow of things.
Roy White.
In that vein, is this mound a particular problem to you? 2 years ago when Catfish Hunter opened for the Yankees, we had a brouhaha over the height of the mound.
Well, he didn't seem to pitch too badly. I guess he won that ball game, but George Toma, the groundskeeper
That's
here.
That's the guy.
Has been known to, if you're an overhand pitcher like myself, to kind of raise the mound so the slope isn't as great. And when you do that, you have a tendency to throw the ball high. And I think he does that every time I pitch here.
Count is 2-1 as White fouls it back into the crowd. And again, George Brett is well off the line at third, giving Roy a lot of room should he choose to put it down there.
So the groundskeeper becomes a Royals weapon.
Definitely.
Leave Jordan.
He's a good guy. He does his job.
Shot to right. Fair ball on the line. Going to the corner. Ricochet played well by Collins. White into second. Double.
Roy White, of course, is the dependable, underpublicized, unsung Yankee. Not well regarded by the management during the season. As we look at this Leonard pitch again, he got it up there and in, and Roy seized upon it. They tried to trade him to Oakland. He, as a man under the 10-5 rule, a senior Yankee, 10 years in the majors, 5 with one club, vetoed the trade. Look at the records. When they play White, they have a better winning percentage than when he's on the bench.
Brian Doyle, second baseman, fouls it away for strike one. This program, an exclusive presentation of ABC Sports. Let's pause 5 seconds to allow our local stations to identify themselves.
WAB New York.
Roy White leads off at second base with one out. One strike count on Doyle. Bucky Dent on deck. Foul back here.
Brian Doyle is little known to anybody except that he is the younger brother of Denny Doyle, the former Major League infielder, who was a travel ball player but gave the Red Sox good service in recent years.
Brian's just a spray hitter. Hits the ball.
An Eddie Stanky type. Without as much ability as Eddie, which was limited.
A two-strike pitch. Inside. One and two. Roy White has a big lead off second base.
But Doyle is a scrapper, and he'll hurt you occasionally.
So he's just trying up there right now, trying to make contact. He's a pretty good breaking ball hitter that likes the fastball down.
See the edge that White has is off second base, and the pitch is fouled away into the seats. And the count holds at one and two.
What's unusual is if you look at the Kansas City outfield, the left fielder and the center fielder are playing Brian Doyle to hit the opposite way, and Al Cowens is over expecting him to pull. That's kind of unusual. Maybe they're going to throw him some breaking balls.
Slow. Two and two now. There's your left fielder. And up in center field, you have Otis, who's shaded toward left center, and a huge chunk of acreage between the position of the center fielder and the right fielder. 2-2 pitch, foul. A defensive swing.
As long as it doesn't come up here.
A little note for the folks in New York, there are no longer any bleacher tickets available for the games when they move back to Yankee Stadium on Friday. All the tickets have been sold. They're all sold here. Reddit, third base, had him played precisely right, but Frank White could not get to second in time to double Roy White. So you've got two out and White still at second base.
And little Brian got good wood on
him. Sure did, but like Frank White said, you play the percentages, you play off the line. The ball was hit right to George Brett.
Bucky Dent. And he's wearing that little protector on his left ankle as he comes to the plate because the foot, his ankle is very, very sore. Even the home run didn't wash away the pain. He hit that yesterday with the Mickey Rivers bat.
Using it again?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, his supply didn't come in. Mickey noticed it was chipped a little bit. Sent the bat boy out with it. It's just off the outside corner.
Well, maybe he's found a new resource.
Though it actually is made the same way and about the same weight and length. Of course, Bucky chokes up on it so much, it wouldn't make a difference how long it was.
It's very tough to strike out.
One pitch. Hotek won't get it. White should score. Roy turns at third, coming to the plate. And he's in as Bucky Dent delivers, and the Yankees take the lead 1-0.
Suddenly, Bucky Dent. He becomes a principal factor in the Yankee batting order. It began yesterday with the seventh inning three-run home run. Look at it again. And Leonard has given up four hits in 1 2/3 innings. The Yankees have been getting to him. He's not been impressive.
I think he's throwing pretty hard. I just don't think he's making very good pitches. He made two mistakes. He threw a fastball down the middle to Roy White when he was ahead. And he threw the fastball down the middle to Bucky Dent. You just can't do that against a good hitting ball club. Bucky Dent started hitting 2 weeks ago, the weekend of the Boston Massacre. He got key hits all in that series.
He really did kill the Red Sox, I must say. 7-15 at one point.
That and injuries.
Well, that's true. But when Burleson went out, the team became disabled.
Well, they had a lot of injuries. Everybody accused them of choking, but I think it's a lot more than that.
Rivers pops it up. Patek backing up. Freddie makes the catch. The inning is over. But the damage is done. A double and a single, and the Yankees take the lead after 1.5, 1-0. Young right-hander Jim Beatty out there ready for the bottom of the second inning. Howard talked to Thurman Munson about it. Let's listen.
Thurman, since you have to go with Beatty, and Guidry can't pitch for several days, do you think this gives the Royals the edge?
I don't think so. You know, Beatty's got a good fastball, and his breaking stuff's real good. If he gets the ball over the plate, which I'm sure he will, and he did his last two or three starts very effectively, I don't think he's going to have that much trouble as far as their hitting's concerned. I think what he's going to have trouble is they get a lot of guys on base, or if he's a little wild, and running's their game, and they get a lot of guys who can move, and I'm not real physically fit right now, so it's going to be interesting.
2 points. Beatty's weakness, has he?
Some pregame comments from Yankee catcher Thurman Munson relative to the young right-hander who came up to the Yankees from Tacoma in the Coast League, April 18, replacing Don Gullett. Gullett was put on the 21-day disabled list. Darryl Porter is at the plate, and that is fouled away.
Hitter than I would think he could be, Jim. With
he's a Charlie Lyle type of hitter. He hits the ball where it's pitched, doesn't have a whole lot of power, but if you throw the ball out over the plate like that, he'll go the other way with it.
And for the uninitiated watching this game, Charlie Lau, just mentioned by Jim Palmer, is the batting coach of the Birds of Baltimore.
Used to be. Right now he's with the Royals.
That's correct. But he was the guy who made the Birds.
Well, he helped a lot of our hitters. He made Mark Colanger hit 287 one year by working with him every day. If you notice, their hitters, most of them, stand off the plate and they go into the pitch. And the reason for this is they want to wait as long as they can. They see the ball longer. And they also hit the ball where it's pitched. And I think a lot of this has to do with the artificial turf.
By the way, it was the presence of Charlie Lau in Baltimore that caused Mickey Vernon in Montreal to leave there. And he signed on with the Yankee organization as a batting instructor.
Full count, 3-2 now on Pete LeCocq. Not only a solid fellow at the plate, but very solid defensively. He made only 5 errors during his past season, and at no time did he commit the mistake that hurt the ball club. And he has just now been patient enough against young Beatty to accept the base on balls. And so Kansas City has its first base runner of the ball game. Al McRae, speaking of tough outs, is at the plate.
He is a tough out. Most of you will remember that 2 years ago he was at least temporarily embittered over a play by an outfielder named Steve Bry that cost him the batting title.
Ah, ball one.
Later he regretted it. There's Whitey Herzog. But his teammate, George Brett, beat him out by a fraction of a point for the title.
Al Cowens is on deck. Steps into it, looks at high, and it's 2 balls and no strikes. And Beatty now is searching for the strike zone.
He pitched last Friday night under great pressure at the stadium against Cleveland. He began to fall into this pattern of falling behind the hitters. But he held together, and the Yankees won that game 3-1.
He might very well have taken a swing at ball three.
Most definitely, Keith, but he's an aggressive type hitter, and he can hit the ball as hard to right field as he can to left field. It's not a good idea to get behind him.
Inside, LeCocq going, throw through, safe. The throw was off to the right field side on second base. Depp did the best he could to flag it. And LeCocq sliding away from the tag is in there.
Now that's the very thing the Yankees are worried about. Beatty is a big kick pitcher. He can't hold the runners to the base. You heard Thurman Munson say he's not in the best physical condition, meaning in this kind of play, a damaged finger. And so they want to keep the men off the bases as much as possible. Don't let him get on with walks. LeCocq got on with a walk. Now he's in scoring position.
4 to Hal McRae. And the Royals now are in business with one out. Base runners at first and second, and here comes Al Collins.
Now this batter is a guy who was second to Rod Carew a year ago in the most valuable player ballot. He is a fine, all-purpose ball player who can do it all. This year, he has had his troubles with injuries. He's fallen off his prior pace. And he's vulnerable, isn't he, Jim, to the high inside pitch, the way he holds the bat?
Usually, Howard. He one time hit a fastball that I threw up and in into the bullpen here, but most of the, he likes the ball out over the plate. And I'll tell you, we all in Baltimore, we threw him a lot of breaking stuff this year and got him out pretty well. But he strained knee ligaments early in the year. He was slumping at the time. It took him a while to get back. But he's a dangerous hitter, and last year he hit 23 home runs and drove in 118 runs.
Interesting to note how he cocks the bat. He drops the point of the bat or the tip of the bat toward the ground. Lets it hang down, and then as the pitch comes, he levels it and steps into it. Popped up, coming back, out of play. One and one.
Beattie's minor league pitching coach was Hoyt Wilhelm, the famed knuckleballer. When they sent him back this year after an unfortunate appearance against the Red Sox, well, let's watch this pitch, Keith.
As Ken Clay gets up in the Yankee bullpen. 1-1 pitch. Popped up on the right side, and it's going to be in the seats out of play.
Different people claim credit for the change in bid. He was sent back after that unfortunate appearance with the Red Sox. Billy Martin says that the last thing he did was make Beattie a no-wind-up pitcher. There are others who say that the owner had him sent to the minors and sent Clyde King down to work with him, and they transformed him to the no-wind-up delivery. But the no-wind-up delivery, reminiscent of Don Larsen, is what's changed him and made him an effective pitcher.
He was the rookie pitcher of the year for the Yankees in spring training this year. He's the best young pitcher I saw in Florida all year.
1-2 pitch to Collins. Foul. Just foul.
And I believe because of roster problems, they sent him out.
There's Clay cranking up. Another big, young, strong right-hander. Comes back at 1-2, and this is a test of the composure of the young right-hander. With Lecoq at second base, he stole it, and McRae then walked. One out. Hotek is waiting. And if you're not in your strike zone against Hotek, he can be very troublesome. Cowan swings and misses, and he's gone, and it was a relatively feeble effort.
There you see a slider. Perfect pitch right on the corner. You can do that when you're ahead of the count 1-2. He wouldn't be doing that 3-2 or 2-2. He'd be going with his best pitch, which is his fastball. The key to pitching is getting ahead of the hitters, and you see how he got rid of Al Collins when he did that.
Make them swing or hit at your best pitch under the circumstances. If you're ahead, you can do it for sure. Now Hotek. And pops him up. And Beattie calls everybody off and makes the catch himself, and he wiggles off the hook. So the Royals come up with a threat, but they can't penetrate this big right-hander, and the Yankees continue to lead after 2-1-0.
Right there, you see a piece of baseball news today. The Indians traded their ace reliever, Jim Kern, the big right-hander, and Lavelle blanks the infielder to the Texas Rangers for Len Barker, who showed well 2 years ago, not so much this year, but the potential is there. And Bobby Bonds, the much-traveled outfielder with a world of ability, 30 homers this year, 30 stolen bases, Jim.
Texas needs pitching, I guess. The only way you can think about that trade and rationalize it, I guess.
You think it's a bad trade for Texas?
I like Bobby Bonds. Scares me when I'm pitching.
For the Yankees, Munson, Pinella, Jackson, and Dennis Leonard, ball one on his first pitch to Thurman Munson. Yankees are leading by a score of 1-0 as White doubled and Bucky Dent singled him home in the top of the second inning. Just outside for ball two. Dick Houser coaching at third, Gene Michael coaching at first for New York. Lou DeMuro back at the plate. And Munson hits it toward Brett. George backs up on it on the artificial surface and throws him out. You can back up on this kind of surface to set yourself on grass. It could cost you, but here the ball travels so quickly, you can get away with it.
George Brett's got one of the best throwing arms of any third baseman in the league. And like I said, Dennis Leonard said he's been playing great defensive ball.
He has stabilized that arm. It used to be errant frequently.
You saw the playoff.
That's right, at the very top of the telecast. That's right.
Exactly.
But now, consistency. And a fine, fine natural hitter. Brilliant hitter.
Lou Piniella is at the plate. And Leonard's right in there for strike one. Piniella aboard on a fielder's choice. Got as far as third in the first inning. His first time up. That's low and away.
Interesting thing about Dennis Leonard, Keith, he grew up in the New York area, out in Long Island. He was well scouted by the Yankees.
Pops him up. Porter almost fell down getting away, and he and Pete LeCocq don't get together on it, and the ball rolls into the dugout free.
Well, look at that again, and as we do, Al Cuccinello of the famous Cuccinello family, his brother was Tony, in baseball, that is, famous. There you see the mix-up. Was the Yankee scout. He rendered a favorable report on Dennis Leonard, but for whatever reason, the Yankees didn't go after him the way they should have. The competition was too great. So they missed up on a pitcher who this year won 21 games.
Piniella hits it to right for Al Cowens. And that's two out. So they dodged the bullet there as Piniella got a second life and flies out to Cowens in right field. Quite likely, that should have been LeCocq's ball all the way in front of the dugout because he could come straight to it as Porter almost fell down and coming off of the dirt onto the rug. The batter now, Reggie Jackson, singled his first time up.
This is the kind of way you want to face Reggie with nobody on the bases and two outs. Tough hitter.
Well, he went right to the truth of it and talking to him this summer when he said one of the reasons he hits so well in September, October is pitchers lose about a yard off their hottest pitch. That ball is well hit to right center field. It's against the boards. Otis is thrown. Jackson stands at second. A double.
Well, you see here, he threw him a low fastball in the middle of the plate. Similar to the two pitches, two of the three pitches he hit for home runs last year in the World Series.
Reggie is a pronounced low ball hitter. He loves it down there.
He likes that, and he likes the slider. You got to pitch him high and tight, high and away, and hope that when he does hit the ball to left field, it just won't hit it as hard and it'll stay in the ballpark.
Batter is Greg Nettles, Yankee third baseman, flat out center field. The first inning, deep, sending Otis to the wall. High and away. When this guy has that swing in the groove, when he's level with it, he is terrifying, though.
Sure is, Keith. I don't know what it is, but against Baltimore, it never looks like he takes a bad swing. And the people, I think, that watched him in the playoffs in the World Series, of course, last year, he barreled into somebody at second base and I think hurt his ribs. They haven't seen the real Greg Nettles. He's a tremendous fielder, and anytime you can hit 20, 25, 30 home runs a year, you can hit.
Jackson off second. Two out. Pitch is inside, breaking pitch to Nettles, and it's two balls and no strikes. Very comfortable. The wind now is very quiet. Freddie Patek is playing Greg Nettles almost back at second base. Frank White is in short right field. Inside corner, call strike. Again, testimony to the artificial surface. Galen Sisco, the pitching coach for Kansas City, watching Leonard from the dugout.
One of the original Mets.
And a former fullback for Woody.
That's right.
Hit well to right. It is off the wall, right in the corner. Jackson will score. Nettles going for three. He's there. Yankees lead 2-0.
He really got his pitch then, Jim.
I'm not sure, Howard. I think he might have thrown him a high slider.
In tight, Jim. Where he could get around on.
Well, usually that's a good pitch if you're throwing good. Maybe Dennis isn't throwing as good as he looks.
That was within a yard of being in the
seats.
That's
right. Barely missed. So for the moment at least, they've saved a run. Unwitting.
Chris Chambliss, Yankee first baseman. Struck out swinging first time. 2-0 New York. Jackson's double. Nettles triple. Two out. Now we get activity in the Kansas City bullpen as Leonard is on the corner for strike one. Mingori and Bird, Doug Bird and Steve Mingori up quickly in the Kansas City bullpen. Yankees now have six hits off Leonard. Chambliss swings and misses. It's two strikes on Chris. Six hits in 2 2/3 innings, and Whitey Herzog's concerned.
He should be.
Don't blame him. That's right.
But Kansas City is a sleeping giant. If the Yankees remember any one thing about him, it's the way George Brett's three-run homer tied the score in the ninth in the fifth game of the 76 playoffs.
Brett way off the line at third with Chambliss up there. It doesn't matter because Chris is caught looking and he's still struggling at the plate. Dennis Leonard gets out of the inning, but the Yankees touch him for one more run and they lead after 2.5, 2-0. He'll be here in Kansas City tomorrow afternoon at 3 Eastern time for game number 2 between the Yankees and the Royals. Tomorrow night at 8 Eastern time, the National League Championship Chip Series gets underway with Bert Hooten for Los Angeles, Larry Christensen for Philadelphia at a Veterans Stadium. Al Michaels, Don Drysdale, and Johnny Bench. We'll have that one for you. We're delighted to be in Kansas City. You really feel like autumn is coming on a day like today with the blue sky and the wind and the leaves starting to tumble off the trees. And a baseball game that carries an enormous meaning, particularly here where they have supported their baseball team to the tune of better than 2.25 million people this year, went over 2 million last year. But they've yet to hang a flag other than the Western Division flag on the pole.
They've got the best sports complex here in the country, Keith, no question about it. Between Royal Stadium and Arrowhead, it is terrific.
Frank White leads off for the Royals in the bottom of the third inning with the Yankees on top 2-0. Then we'll go back to the top of the order for Steve Braun and George Brett.
This is an athlete in the vogue of the absent Willie Randolph. He's had an excellent year, trained in Ewing Kauffman's Baseball Academy.
I believe he's the only player that ever graduated to get to the major leagues.
That's true. Got a lot of talent.
Count is now 2-1.
Run, field, throw, and how he's improved his hitting.
Well, he came up 30 points this year. He's hit 275 after hitting 245 last year. They play him the right center. He doesn't have a whole lot of power that way.
But popped up. Nettles bounces at first. Great play.
What a great play.
As well as Nettles.
Both ends, Keith.
I didn't think Greg could get there. Beatty coming off the mound almost got in his way. Now watch here. The pitcher's almost in between. He finally clears it for Nettles. Greg gets enough on it. Big bounce. And fortunately for Chambliss and the Yankees, a true bounce.
That's another angle. Still not an easy play for Chambliss because of the runner.
One out, Steve Braun, the top of the order. is thrown out by the second baseman, Brian Doyle, to the pitcher covering his first time. He was a little grouchy about the trade that brought him over from Seattle. He and his family had settled in Bellevue. They were very happy there, and he thought about it a while before he came over, but now he's happy he did. Fly ball lifted to Mickey Rivers in center for out number two.
This is a very big game, of course, for Kansas City, because they want to win at home, both games. And they want to beat the young pitcher, Beardy.
I would think if the Yankees can get out of here with a split, they can afford to save Guidry if they have to as late as Saturday. High fly ball hit to right field by George Brett. And Lou Piniella makes the catch to end the inning. So we continue to roll along with Beardy dominating. He's given no hits, and the Yankees lead 2-0. Two previous meetings between these two teams, 1976 and 77, it went down to the final inning. As a matter of fact, to the final out in the final game before New York was able to win, each of them margins 3-2. Roy White stands at the plate, having doubled and scored the Yankees' first run. Then it'll be Brian Doyle and Bucky Dent for New York in the top of the fourth inning, as White fields it cleanly and throws White out easily. One away, and here comes Doyle as Frank White gets the first out.
Leonard, in giving up six hits in 3 3rd innings, has escaped relatively well, allowing only two runs in the process. Kansas City is a dynamite ball club with its team speed, its consistent hitting. Long way to go.
They're a tough club late innings. They hit the ball, like I said, where it's pitched, and you get a little bit tired. Those pitches you throw by them don't get by them, and they end up singles and doubles.
The Kansas City bullpen is now quiet, and that's a foul ball in the Yankee dugout.
It should be quiet. Leonard, 121. He lost 17. Those 17 losses deserve closer examination. Five of those losses were one-run games. In 11 losses, Keith, the Royals only scored two runs or less for him. So he had some well of a year.
I would think the pitchers' union would have filed a grievance on his behalf.
Palmer would.
American. I asked him how he felt. You know, a guy pitches 295 innings, you think he'd be tired. He says, I didn't even get in shape till July. So he said he felt fine. And he's throwing a ball hard. He just hasn't been making very good pitches.
You were fined 500 this year, weren't you?
No, that was last. 2 years ago, I guess. They told me they were going to pay it. The guys were going to take up a collection. And the season ended, I haven't seen it.
The count now to Brian Doyle. Three balls and one strike with one out and nobody on. Leonard works to him. Ball is hit on the right side for Frank White, who cannot come up with it. And Brian Doyle is on. I would think that would be a base hit.
I would think.
The shortstop, Bucky Dent.
So Frank White is way up the middle. He has to go way to his left. The ball picks up speed, like you said, Keith. Just a tough play. I doubt if he could have thrown him out, even if he had caught it.
Couldn't have. Left-handed batter. He was well down the line. He's got good speed.
Bucky Dent knocked in the first New York run. Here goes Doyle. The pitch is high on the right side and playable for LeCocq. First baseman makes the catch. Doyle is back at first base.
So Mick the Quick comes up, and so far he's been kept off the bases.
That's the key to beating New York. But they are down by two runs, so I guess it's not the only key.
One of the things about Dennis Leonard's comeback is he was struggling early. Normally every second day on a 4-5 day rotation, according to the pitching order here in Kansas City, between the starts, the pitchers are expected to work out 7, 8, 9, 10 minutes a day, whatever's comfortable for him, but he quit doing it. And for some reason, it helped him.
Rested his own.
One of those fragile little intangibles that everybody pursues and only occasionally finds.
It's funny.
That was your problem, as I remember, at Washington State.
Still chasing. Most pitchers, when they don't pitch well, have a tendency to overthrow on the bullpen. So I guess he did the best thing for him.
Foul back. Strike one on Mickey Rivers.
He was loose and easy in the clubhouse before the game. Paul Blair said, why shouldn't we be? We're here by a miracle.
Well, Paul feels that way. He told me to thank Earl publicly for getting him over here.
That pitch just misses.
I think you pitched your first game, major league game for Baltimore, the day Blair broke in, back in 65 at Fenway.
Hit
right?
his home run off Bill Mombouquet.
And a double. And
I
you worked in relief.
Robin Roberts.
That's when Tony Conigliaro was a singer.
That is when I faced him with the bases loaded, the first time I ever pitched in the major leagues.
What happened?
Struck him out on three pitches. The next guy singled.
They're trying to hold Doyle at first base with Rivers at the plate. Two out. Count is 1-1 on the batter.
Leonard said he just hates to pitch to Mickey Rivers. He just doesn't know what pitch he's going to hit.
Neither does Mickey. Inside. 2-1.
For a little guy, he can hit the ball.
That's right. Drives you crazy. He's got that occasional power, and suddenly there's the deep drive to left center off the wall or the pulled pitch that'll go out of the ballpark to right field.
I had an 8-0 lead in Anaheim once and two outs, and he hit a ball off the post to try to stress it in and inside to Parker. Got thrown out the plate.
That's shot to right. That's in there for a base hit. Collins is over to cut it off. Doyle headed for third. Throw comes across. Nope. That's cut off by Pontek.
So Mr. Munson gets up in a clutch situation, and Mr. Leonard continues to struggle. He has given up 8 hits in 3 2/3 innings, but still only 2 runs. And that's what Kansas City is concerned about. Their task now to stay close because they can explode at any time.
Left-hander Steve Mingori is up in the Kansas City pen for the second time. With two out, runners at the corners for New York as they lead 2-0. I'll tell you something, that youngster Doyle can move it around those bases.
He can run. I'll tell you something else. Lost opportunities, as you know, Keith, being a veteran in this business, somehow add up and work against you later in the game, and Absolutely. The Yankees are not capitalizing on opportunities.
Absolutely. Not yet.
Not yet is correct.
It's a tough decision for Whitey Herzog. He's got his best pitcher going. You don't want to take him out in the third inning, the fourth inning, excuse me.
Ball is hit well to left by Thurman Munson as Braun goes back to the warning track, back to the wall, and makes the catch. Once again, a sigh of relief in Kansas City. After 3.5, 2-0, New York. Can look at Thurman Munson as he chases Braun to the wall before Steve can make the catch to end the inning.
Looked like a hanging slider.
It was, and a healthy Munson probably would have hit that ball out. The Munson swing is simply not there. Did you notice the way he holds that bat up now?
He's not taking a full swing like he usually does. On the other hand, Dennis Leonard did say this is probably the biggest park in the league, and if you can throw fly balls here, even if you're unhealthy, you got a chance to win. It's the ground balls that hurt you.
To me, the key is that Leonard's given up 8 hits in 4 innings and only 2 runs. And Kansas City very much alive.
With Amos Otis, Darryl Porter, and Pete LeCocq to get their second look at the offerings of the young right-hander, Jim Beatty. Otis stands in. He struck out swinging first time. That pitch is high for ball one. Otis started this baseball season at 194 pounds. But over the last few months, he's been playing as low as 170. And he just can't add weight. He eats 4 meals a day plus a sandwich, and he still can't keep his weight up. That's ball two.
Beatty has a very deceptive pitching motion, but it's no good if you can't throw the ball over the plate. And he's consistently getting behind the hitters.
Meanwhile, Herzog is troubled because he's behind, but he's an old pro. Had a long tenure in the Yankee organization. He knows his club. can come back quickly. I'm sorry, Keith.
Three balls and no strikes now on the leadoff man here in the bottom of the fourth inning. It's the second time around through the Kansas City order.
There's the no windup motion. He steps towards first base. Almost like he steps towards first and throws back to home plate. He really opens up his left shoulder quickly, and that's not conducive to throwing strikes. I know you mentioned that Clyde King worked with him, but when I saw him this spring, he was the most impressive pitcher I've seen in many years. He pitched very well against us both. They sent him out because I guess they didn't have room for him, but he
pitched. Well, they sent him out after a bad performance against the Red Sox. When George Steinbrenner fell, he simply needed more experience downstairs.
He has walked Otis. Here comes Porter now as the crowd begins to make some noise.
That was a revealing graphic we showed you a moment ago. The Yankees, 8 hits, only 2 runs. The Royals, no hits, no runs, 1 error. But Peady getting gradually behind the hitters.
I have a feeling, I think, that the Royals know that Munson can't throw, because you got Amos Otis at first, Pete. LeClaque's already still second base. They'll all run at any time.
There he goes. Throw through. No,
not even close. And it's not just the fact that Thurman's injury prevents him from throwing well. It is the fact that Peady is a high kick pitcher who does not know how to hold runners to the base.
Right? You're right, Howard. The most important thing for a pitcher to do is to get, number one, to get him from keeping him from getting a running lead, and then get rid of the ball as quickly as you can.
1-1 to Porter. The pitch that Darrell took when Otis took off was a strike.
That was Peady's third walk. The foul to Otis. That foul, 10 feet higher and 20 feet to the right, would have nestled in Mr. Jackson's chest.
That would have been under the table.
Those singers coming back here are not friends.
That ball is pulled sharply foul on the right side.
You know, you watch a player like Darryl Porter and you realize the wonders of sport, in a sense, what can happen to a human being. A couple of years ago with Milwaukee, a mixed up young man with deep personal problems, betrayed over here, rehabilitated in every way.
He's become a good player, Howard.
1-2 pitch is high. 2-2.
You know, it's nice to, when you're playing in a town like Milwaukee, they have an excellent ball club now, but to come to an organization that's a winner, knows how to win. They have great personnel. Whitey Herzog's a great guy, and Charlie Leal, I'm sure, has worked a lot with Darryl to make him a good hitter.
Pops him up. It's drifting back, and the third baseman, Nettles, is right on the edge of the dugout for the first out.
I must say, Beattie pitched him well. Did not give in to him, Jim.
Exactly. Well, he hasn't been giving in to anybody. He's been throwing the ball as hard as he can. He throws a breaking ball when he thinks it's the right pitch. And right there, he had the count 2-2, and he threw a fastball up and away, which is the way you want to pitch Darryl Porter. I'm not sure if he did it on purpose, but I think he's just letting him throw the ball as hard as he can.
LeClaque is up now. Walked and stole second this first time. One out. And Amos Otis is at second. Time call for the moment.
I think Thurman's a little bit concerned about Amos stealing third base.
I don't blame him, because he's been way out there on the carpet for quite a while. LeClaque swings and fouls it at the plate.
You mentioned stealing third, and the Royals have a history of that. The players who will steal and even steal third are Willie Wilson, who's not in there, Freddie Patek, Amos Otis, and George Brett.
Punch foul.
You're right, Howard. I'm sitting here. I just know full well that the fuse is getting shorter.
Maury Wills was the master of stealing third. He is the teacher at the business, and stealing third is easier in many instances than stealing second.
Bounced over the pitcher's mound. Big hop for the second baseman, Doyle. Good play by Bryan. Otis moves over to third.
Excellent play. Especially the snap throw.
Here, Beatty throws him a sinker, makes a good pitch, which sometimes isn't a good pitch on artificial turf. And where? Who needs Willie Randolph? Comes in and makes a great, nice play.
You can ask that question in the fourth inning, but we'll discuss it in the ninth.
Hal McCray. One hit off Beatty since Jim came to the Yankee organization and stayed. Two out now.
Whoa. DeMuro gives you that pitch, doesn't he?
Well, I would say he's one of the more liberal umpires. A lot of times you'd call him a pitcher's umpire. He'll give you that pitch maybe an inch or two off the plate. I always thought it was deserved. The fans here, of course, think that that first pitch was a ball, too. A lot of it has to do with your catcher. If he's sitting off the plate and you throw the ball where the glove is, you'll get the pitch. There are some umpires, of course, that they're hitters umpires. You have to throw it over the plate.
2-1 to Hal McCray.
I like the way you say that, hitters umpires, don't you, Keith?
Tuck that away.
It's funny, a lot of the guys that I think are hitters umpires, the hitters think the opposite. They think they're pitchers umpires.
Beatty is gifted with two kinds of fastballs. I guess the best way to describe it would be the riding ball, the ball that rides into a right-hander. And then once in a while, he'll turn it a little bit, it'll sink. And that ball is hit on the right side, into the air to the right fielder, Pinella. And Lou's got it. And the inning is over. And the Royals still have no hits through four innings of play. The Yankees lead 2-0. Steve Mingore remains active in the Kansas City bullpen. This is the third time he has been called up in this ball game, as the Yankees will send to the plate here at the top of the fifth inning Lou Piniella, Reggie Jackson, and Greg Nettles.
What Mingore's appearance in the bullpen means is that Whitey Herzog knows Leonard has escaped relatively unscathed, that he's not throwing well, that the Yankees have not been able to make their hits count for runs in the numbers they should have. 8 hits, 2 runs, and 4 innings. And Whitey wants this thing to stay close till his club can unload on Beatty, if they can.
Inside, ball one. Pinella, a fielder's choice, and a fly ball to right. Right center field, it's in for the base hit. Cowens comes over, cuts it off in the alley, and Lou's aboard. Yankees have the leadoff man on here in the top of the fifth inning.
Just another fastball in the middle of the plate. You can't pitch Lou Piniella. You got to either go way in on him, which he did the first time and he flew out, or you got to throw him a sharp breaking ball.
There is, by the way, as Whitey comes right out, knowing the situation, a problem with Mingore. He has not been pitching well this year. He's not been throwing well recently. And we'll have more on that as we watch Mingore get ready to come in when we return to Royal Stadium in just one moment.
Left-hander Steve Mingore pitched 6-9 innings this year in relief with an earned run average of 274, but with a record of 1-4. And you look at the book that the opposition has put together on Steve, and you wouldn't think they have the highest regard for him, but he is, while not the fastest pitcher in Major League Baseball, has the faculty sometimes for moving the ball into those spots that would be useful. Being a left-hander, he should be able to hold Pinella on at first base with Jackson up at the plate. The move dictated by Reggie's presence, and it brought Whitey Herzog quickly out of the dugout. So here we are with Mingore.
Lou's not going anywhere anyway. He's not known for his speed, but he does have an excellent move.
Well, he's got a strike on Reggie.
Well, I've seen Mingore stifle the Yankees in the past. I've also seen him get slugged in the past by left-handed batters, too. But Herzog was on the ball.
That pitch is inside, gets away from Porter. Pinella's at second. Fastball moves him up to second base. And Bird is up in the Kansas City bullpen throwing. 2-0. Nobody out. Here in the top of the fifth inning. That pitch just low. Reggie with a single and a double. He scored once. Foul. Hit well, but foul.
He was looking for that pitch and swung out in front of it.
Well, I'm sure Reggie's trying to get Pinella over right now. That's his job. I think he'd like to do it with a home run, but you would like to get that runner to third base with one out or get him home with a base hit.
Whoops.
Breaking pitch. Reg almost chased it. It's full now, 3-2.
That's his most effective pitch against a left-handed hitter. He throws a sinker. He throws a screwball. But most left-handed hitters, especially Reggie, are low-ball hitters. The screwball is not effective. A great pitcher that played with us for years, Mike Cuellar, the only hitter he ever threw it to was a guy like Tony Oliva. He couldn't get him out with anything else. So right now, the pitch that he's going to probably use would be a breaking ball.
Big, wide, flat, sweeping curve, and it's way outside, and Jackson's aboard. So, the New York Yankees, with 9 base hits, but only 2 runs, have Lou Piniella at second base, Reggie Jackson at first base, nobody out. Steve Mingori has come on in relief here in the top of the fifth inning of Dennis Leonard with 4 innings plus, both runs charged to Leonard. And, of course, Piniella will be the responsibility of Leonard. In the first 4 innings of play, New York had 5 hitters up in each inning. The Yankees have been busy every inning, but so far have broken through for only 2 runs. As Greg Nettles hits it on the ground to Frank White. Over to second, they've got Reggie Jackson going down as Piniella moves over to third, and Patek holding onto the ball. So that's one out. Fielder's choice as Greg Nettles stops at first base.
I'll tell you, the Royals from the start of the game have been flirting with disaster as we look at this again, because one key Yankee hit at the right time would break the game open. The Yankees haven't been able to do it. As here, the force of Reggie.
Smart play by Pata.
Right, he knew he couldn't execute the double play, but maybe Piniella would overrun third and he could pick him off. Meantime, Chambliss, who struck out twice consecutively, comes to the plate with a tired bat, as we've said, and yet with the capacity for the big hit. Right, Keith?
Yes, sir.
Nettles off first. Piniella off third. One out. Hit to the right side. Base hit. Piniella scores, and Nettles is going to third. Cut off by Patek as Greg goes sliding in on his stomach.
That's a familiar Chris Chambliss trademark. He hits southpaws reasonably well, sometimes very well, and he'll get the key hit for you.
Perfect place for a left-handed hitter. You have the runner being held by the first baseman. He makes a bad pitch. It's on the inside part of the plate. He hits a routine ground ball, but the runner's being held on by the first baseman. The ball goes by him.
Attaway.
And the Yankee lead now is 3-0.
Excuse me, Keith, but when you come in there, you just have to throw the ball away. You got to make a good pitch. Mingori didn't do it. It wasn't hit very hard. It just was hit in the right spot, and the reason for that was because the ball was on the inside part of the plate.
Roy White now switches to the other side, hitting right-handed against Mingori. He doubled off Leonard and rolled to the second baseman. Swing and a miss for strike one. Doug Bird is warming back of Mingori in the Kansas City pen. Brian Doyle is on deck for New York with one out. Pitch is just low. This program, an exclusive presentation of ABC Sports. Let's pause 5 seconds to allow our local stations to identify themselves.
WABC-TV, New York.
Wouldn't be surprised to see him hit and run here.
Let's see if they do a little hitting and running. That's popped up on the right side for Frank White, drifting back into short right field to make the catch. Sets himself. And the throw quickly in, and the runner holds at third.
You won't often see Roy White fail to deliver. As a matter of fact, in the opening game of the 76 playoffs, Roy White got the key hit batting right-handed, lashing a double down the left field line, which enabled Catfish Hunter to defeat Larry Gura. At that time, he couldn't deliver, so the Yankees still failed to take full advantage of their opportunities with Brian Doyle up.
As a single and two trips, first time lined the ball sharply to Brett at third, rolled it to the right side and beat it out for a base hit. Runner still on the corners, the Yankees leading 3-0 as Doyle fouls it away. And you've got two out. Top of the fifth inning. And that's Doug Bird, the right-hander in the Kansas City pen. Off the stretch. Ball is hit sharply to right field. That'll be a base hit. Almost hit Chambliss. Run scores from third, and the Yankees lead 4-0.
So the diminutive Eddie Stanky-like ball player provides another unexpected Yankee hero, which has been part of the storyline of the Yankees over the recent years.
Almost put a hole in Chris. He went in second, he fell down, he gets up. Now watch, he staggers some, then goes on into second base. Gene Monahan, the trainer, has gone out to second to check on Chris and see if he's all right.
Chris with a big grin. Oh, well.
He runs well for a big guy.
After all, UCLA.
He was tough out there, too. So Brian Doyle delivering here in the first game of the American League Championship Series against Kansas City is 2-for-3. And it's just knocked in a run.
What did we say at the very beginning? Ball Blair.
The pitch to Bucky Dent. Strike.
Bucky Dent. Lou Piniella as a fielder. Give the Yankees credit. They produce the unexpected hero.
They sure do.
Rolled on the ground to Patek at short. Do it himself. The inning is over. But the Yankees come up with 2 runs. They now have a total of 4 to lead 4-0 in the middle of the fifth inning. American League Championship Series tomorrow afternoon at 3 Eastern Time. It'll be Eddie Figueroa, the first Puerto Rican pitcher ever to win 20 in the major leagues, against Larry Gura, who was the big surprise for Kansas City. And then tomorrow night, it will be Los Angeles and Philadelphia at 8 Eastern Time with Bert Hooten for Los Angeles against Larry Christensen for the Phillies. On a baseball tomorrow, so join us right here on ABC.
What a year Hooten's had.
Al Cowens, who struck out swinging the first time, swings and misses on the first pitch from Jim Beattie for strike one.
Jim, explain again, Jim Palmer, if you will, why Beattie is a deceptive pitcher.
Well, he has a very slow delivery. And when normally when a pitcher goes towards home plate, he goes directly to the plate. He kind of lists towards the first base line, and he throws back towards, look at that ball. That ball was in on Cowens. The ball ran back. Looks to me he's throwing above 90 miles per hour. He throws some pitches high. This one you'll see right here. The ball, look at the ball run in. Cowens just gets handcuffed.
Running fastball.
Exactly. And one of the keys is, like I said, getting ahead of the pitcher, the hitters. And then if your fastball moves, and his ball, like he said last inning, he throws one that rises, which you throw across the seams, you throw another one that sinks, you throw with the seams. And he's throwing the ball all over the place. If he can get enough strikes, he's tough to hit.
On the chalk, fair ball, long throw. Well, waved it off foul. Boy, that thing bit the chalk, and it just was outside the bag when it went across at third. An inch.
But it really was a beautifully executed play. It's worth looking at again.
Like an off-speed pitch.
Yeah.
Hanging curveball.
It tied him up. It tied Cowens up. And there's Nettles deep behind the bag with a great arm, but getting rid of it quickly. All right, we're back to live action.
That's punched. That's going to fall. That's the first base hit of the ball game for Kansas City. And excuse me, swing. And the first hit off the Yankee right-hander. I think Cowens felt he should have had a hit down the chalk line at third base, so he checks on it. Just a little bit of a punch, and it drops in.
I love the way Chambliss picked up the throw, the pickup, and the throw by Nettles. Okay, there they are. Cowens, Chambliss, And here's where Beardy has a problem because Cowan's can run, but you don't usually steal trailing 4-0.
I don't know, Coward. I think they're going to run. That's their trademark.
Yeah, they're running. They have to.
Well, I'm sure that Thurman's finger has a lot to do with it. If Thurman was throwing like he did, not too many people run on him. He has one of the quickest releases, if not the quickest release in baseball.
Well,
not the best arm, but he gets rid of the ball quickly.
Freddy Patek looks it in there for strike one.
Beattie threw twice consecutively to Chambliss to try to hold Cowens to the bag.
That's fine, but it doesn't get rid of the basic problems, which is getting rid of the ball quickly and just having a big windup with a high kick.
It's true.
Foul. But that comes with maturity. I think the worst thing in the world would be to try to change a guy that has a good arm that has been fairly successful doing what he does.
You're really high on that kid. You didn't go to Dartmouth. You went to Arizona State.
That's true. He's got a great arm.
Cowan's off first. 1 foot on the rug. Patek fouls it straight back. You would think with his size that Freddy Patek would be a patient hitter, but it is not so. Against the Yankees this year, first pitch strikes 32 times. He has taken a pull at it 25 times. So he's not patient at all. He just jumps on it if it's in the strike zone. Missed that one, and he's gone.
Looked like a good breaking ball from Beattie.
And it was down. Look at it drop.
That's what gets hitters out. No doubt about that. Freddie's a high fastball hitter, and if you make pitches like that, you're going to get him out most of the time. I guess he really struggled with the bat the last month. He was hitting as good as he did last year,
sore
which was about 265, 270.
Real sore shoulder.
I know he had a sore shoulder at the All-Star game. It was on his throwing arm. I don't know if that bothers hitting or not.
Frank White's up. Rounded out to third. First time up. Hits this ball in the air. Foul to the right side. It's back in the crowd. Out of play. One out as Kansas City gets its first base hit off Jim Beattie. A single looped to short center field by Al Cowens. After making a bid for an extra base hit down the line. Just missed it. Popped him up. Brandor. Got it. Two down. It's the top of the order now for Steve Braun, who is 0 for 2. This crowd is just waiting to scream about something. They had their first real chance to yell moments ago when the leadoff man singled to center, but since that time, Beattie has retired Patek and White. Braun looks, high and away, ball one.
Remember, Braun likes the ball on the inside of the plate, likes to hit inside out down the left field fountain.
Popped him up on the left side. Catcher Thurman Munson going to the dugout. Reaches in, falls in, can't get it.
I tell you, Thurman took a gamble there against hurting himself and already injured ball player. This year, Keith and I saw Butch Hobson of the Red Sox make two of the greatest catches you'd ever want to see, challenging the dugout, challenging his own very existence. Let's look at this again.
I'm sure his teammates are ready to catch him. You can see them getting ready right here when they see him going in the dugout. You usually do that. Well, maybe they aren't going to help.
You know, every time I see a play do that, I remember Earl Batty against the Dodgers in the World Series, the Minnesota
catcher. Right. 1965.
They padded the railings right after he hit that.
Yep. 1-1 pitch to Braun. He's outside. It's 2-1. It's two out.
Jim Palmer, you're absolutely right. He's all over the place. He's up high. He's down low. He moves that ball around. The delivery is deceptive, and the velocity is there.
Again, just missing outside. So it's 3-1.
Sometimes the control's not.
That's right, but he doesn't want to walk this man because George Brett, one of the best natural hitters in baseball, is on tap.
Oh. Ball is hit well to right. For Lou Piniella, makes the catch at the warning track and then bounces off the fence. And the Royals are retired, but at least they do get their first base hit of the ball game after 5-4-0 New York.
Going to Texas.
I know you're going to Texas, and you have a chartered plane ready in case there's a fifth game in this playoff series. You understand?
Yeah. I hear you.
Don't look at me. I got into this town at 4:30 this morning after the Redskins had squelched the Dallas Cowboys.
9-5 football game? 9-5?
What's the matter? It's baseball. It's a baseball score.
It sounds like one of my bad games.
Fits the time of the season. It was a great football game, I'll tell you.
Mickey Rivers, Thurman Munson, Lou Piniella against Steve Mingori. There's that big wide sweeping curve. Mickey was leaning away and it nipped the outside corner. Bounces it over the head of the pitcher and Freddie Patek. Oh, that's close. And that got Gene Michael's stick jumping up and down on the call at first base.
Well, the stick can jump up and down, but that was a great play by Freddie Patek. He knew what he had to do. He knew how he had to do it. He knows Rivers' speed. And he really made a fine play on this. Look at that release. Call was right.
I don't reckon there's anybody who can play this rug better than Freddie. Only 5'4". That growth on his face makes him look bigger.
That's what I told him today.
Makes him heavier.
Thurman Munson. Strike one.
Thurman came up with two on in the fourth and two out. He got the pitch he wanted. It was caught high against the wall by Steve Braun at the 385-foot mark.
Hit to George Brett at third on a gravy bounce. Two out.
The point is, it was that catch that kept this game respectable. And now Mingori seems to have settled down.
For just a moment in the bullpen, for about a half a dozen pitches, it appeared, there was a familiar figure loosening up for New York. Sparky Lyle has not worked much over the last 20 days.
Cy Young Award winner a year ago. All kinds of difficulties this year with the management, within himself. But if ever a man has been a competitor, it's been Sparky Lyle.
Two out for Lou Piniella. Mingori's outside for ball one. That's foul. Little one-hander by Dick Houser at third base. We're talking about Texas a while ago in the Oklahoma football game, but they have developed a remarkable athletic facility at Texas, including a fine baseball stadium down there. Texas A&M, or Doug Rouse out of that A&M group, a lot of good players coming out of that southwestern part of the country, out of the college ranks these days. Stadiums are seating 15, 20,000 people.
All pitchers, no doubt. I'm trying to take my job.
That'll be the thing. In the meantime, Piniella at the plate. We talked about his fielding.
Hit to Patek at shortstop. Throws on the money, and for the first time in the baseball game, in the top of the sixth inning, the Yankees are retired in order after 5.5, 4-0 New York. 4-11-0 New York. 0-1-1 for Kansas City. It's the bottom of the sixth. It is the third time around through the Kansas City batting order for Jim Beatty. It'll be facing George Brett, Amos Otis, and Darryl Porter.
And the crowd, which has been startlingly quiet all night, begins to come to life. They know that George Brett is a fine hitter. They know they trailed by four, but they know their team can hit and can run.
Ball one.
Very much in this game.
Jim's stats for the evening.
All true.
Once again, he's behind the hitter.
strike. Saw Brett slide up the bat handle. You put it down.
This is almost a facsimile, Keith, of the game I saw him pitch against the Indians last Friday night.
Inside, 3-1.
Steadily behind the hitters, but hanging in there. Because, as Jim Palmer has told you, he moves that ball around. The delivery is deceptive.
Strike two. Boy, I tell you, he just leaned back and threw that one right down the pipe. I mean, he's not letting up when he gets behind, which is good. But the key, again, is just getting the ball over the plate. Hit well to right. Home run depth. It is a foul ball. Not foul ball that much.
No, it was not. You can't play around with Brett. He leaves the bench swinging. He can hit any kind of pitch. He is one of the best natural hitters in all of baseball. Has led the American League. He is a top quality player.
Sure is. Hits it up the middle. Base hit number two.
There you go.
He's going to second. He's safe.
And that's the kind of baseball you like to see. Trailing by four runs. The ball perhaps too leisurely played by Mickey Rivers. Take advantage of it. Look at Brett Rounds first. Look at what was happening. And on the move. This is the way Kansas City breaks ball games. And so
right to the base. So George Brett, a hustling double leading off the sixth inning. Here he is going in again, straight ahead. And gets there before Dent can get the ball down. So Brett down at second base, nobody out. Amos Otis, who has struck out and walked, is the batter. George Brett trying to get the Royals a little life here. Gambling play, but he made it. Have a rule you couldn't step out?
Yes, once you got in there.
They don't enforce it?
Nope.
Out of play. One strike on Otis. That double by Brett, the Royals second base hit against Jim Beatty. Now the Yankee bullpen starts moving around. Ken Clay and Sparky Lyle get up and start throwing. Take your time, Amos. There's Brett. He's anxious. He's off second base. Beatty waiting for Otis to get in. One ball and one strike. It's a Yankee bench. Yankee relief pitchers Ken Clay and Sparky Lyle. 2-1. Beatty now getting behind everybody. Got behind Brett. Finally, Brett almost in a home run. Then hit a ground ball up the middle and hustled it into a double. Better to pitch ahead than behind, if possible. Two and two on Otis. Two home runs this year for the Royals and 96 runs batted in. Still 2-2. Has only got 145 base hits this year, but drove in 96 runs. Hit 30 doubles, 7 triples.
He led the club in batting average, home runs, and RBIs.
Doesn't strike out that often, only 54 times all year. 3-2. There's Brett off second base. There's nobody out here in the sixth inning. The Yankees lead 4-0. Royals trying to get on the board. Ball four, working. So Otis walks. And the Royals have two men on base for Darryl Porter. Bob Lemon now will go out to the mound. You got to make him swing the bat.
Yes, they have to. I don't know whether this is Bob's takeout walk or not, but as Bill told you, Sparky Lyle, Kenny Clay out in the bullpen. But you cannot afford to let men get on base with nobody out. Beattie has been pitching a beautiful ball game. Bob's going to let him stay in there. Hall of Famer, Bob Lemon. What a tough pitcher he was to hit against. Didn't know how to throw a straight ball.
Everything moved, huh?
Everything.
Bob managed here at Kansas City for a while.
All right.
This is Darryl Porter. Ball inside. Porter has flied to center field and fouled out.
Now, how about that play? Munson went to throw the ball back. Porter put his bat up. The ball hit the bat, and the umpire didn't call dead ball or anything. I guess it's in play. That is weird.
There it is, right there. Munson jumps on it. 2-0 on Porter. Trying to force the ball inside on Darryl Porter. Royals runners at first and second. Nobody out here in the sixth inning. Yankees ahead 4-0. Three balls, no strikes on Porter. Two on Porter. Well, Porter, normally a pretty good fastball hitter. He's been swinging late on that fastball from Jim Beattie. Runners are going into center field, and Rivers is right there. And there's one away. So Beattie worked himself out of a little jam there. He finally came back for 3-0 count to get Darryl Porter. That'll bring on Pete LeCocq, the first baseman. He's walked, stolen a base, and bounced to second. Bases loaded. George Brett's over at third base. Amos Otis down at second. Pete LeCocq on at first. Out pops Bob Lim. That's going to be all. He wants a right-hander, Ken Clay. Lim has already made the sign for the right-hander. Clay will come on and pitch to Hal McCray. And McCray, of course, is the tying run at the plate. Here's Clay coming on. Now, Petey ran into trouble here in the sixth inning. Gave up, bounced up the middle of George Brett, who hustled into a double. He walked Otis. Got Porter. After going three balls, no strikes on Porter, Porter fly to center field. Then he walked LeCocq on four pitches. Now that's all for Beattie, and Ken Clay comes on. He'll have to pitch to Hal McCray. The base is loaded, one away. So Beattie goes 5 1/3. Gives up no runs on two base hits. Walk five, that hurt him. And struck out three. So he'll leave for Ken Clay.
Guy did a great job up till this inning. Just as Bill said, he must have run out of gas.
Clay's making his 29th appearance, his 23rd relief appearance, has no saves. He's won three games and lost four. In 75 innings pitched, he's given up 89 base hits, three home runs, struck out 32 and walked 21. A tough job here dealing with Hal McCray. Yankees are trying to buy a little time, Scooter, as much time as they can for Ed Figueroa and Ron Guidry, Rich Gossage.
Yeah. Kenny's got a tough job now. He's got to get the ball over the plate, and yet with something on it, and just aim that ball.
Tough situation for a youngster.
Yeah.
Have game two for you tomorrow. We'll be on the air at 3 o'clock right here on Channel 11. 11 alive. Yankees and the Kansas City Royals, the second game of this American League Championship Series. Paul Blair and Beattie over on the end of the pitch. Beattie a little bit upset with himself, but they can come on and do the job here. Everything will be all right. Hal McCray has walked and flied to right field. He's 0 for 1. Yankees have a 4-0 lead, and the Royals, the base is loaded and one away in the sixth inning. McCray, 16 home runs this year, 72 runs batted in, batted 273. Outside, ball one. A play, he'll throw it into second base as Brett scores, and the Yankees now lead 4-1. A sacrifice fly for Hal McCray. Otis goes to third base, and LeCocq stays at first. Here's a play to Pinella. He knows what he's doing. He's just going to go on to second base and keep that runner at first. Brett scored easily. Al Collins has struck out. And single up the middle. He's 1 for 2. Strike on Collins. Well, the Yankees trying to get away with kids here in this opening game. Jim Beattie started. Ken K. Clay coming on in relief. Once wants that ball down. Must be a breaking ball. Top to second base. Brian Doyle is there, and the side is retired. Royals pick up a run. Phil Rizzuto will take you over the next three innings. At the end of six, the Yankees 4, the Royals 1.
Friday, and if necessary, go through Saturday and Sunday with that schedule.
Going back to last inning and the Yankee crisis, which they survived with only one run being given up, give Bob Lemon, the manager, credit. He went out to the mound, peace and tranquility, and he brought in Kenny Clay. Peace and tranquility plus a sinker can save
it. It did last inning. I guess it's hard to second guess the guy that took a team that really was in, I guess, the doldrums, and they went 48-20 under him.
He's a beautiful guy. What a competitor.
Good pitcher, too.
Oh,
great
Hall
pitcher.
Of Famer.
Excuse me.
That's right.
Foul back by Reggie Jackson to be followed by Greg Nettles and Chris Chambliss. For New York in the top of the seventh.
Only one occasion where he ever lost his cool. That was in the first game of the 51 World Series when Dusty Rhodes hit a pop fly that fell into the Polo Grounds right field seats 247 feet away in the first row. And it cost the Indians the first game of the World Series.
Inside for ball one to Reggie, 1-1. Jackson tonight, a single, a double. He scored a run and he's walked. Drifting curve, it's 2-1, it was high.
Correction, did I say 51? 54, of course, when unaccountably the Giants won four in a row over a great Indians team that had set a record for victories in the season.
Oh. Oh. 3-1 now to Reggie Jackson as that curve just missed low.
I don't think Mingori thought so.
Well,
looked
didn't.
Like a pretty good pitch, but those things happen.
Whitey Herzog takes a great deal of patience to be a manager of a baseball club. Pitches outside. So Mingori walks the leadoff man for the Yankees in the top of the seventh inning. It is very important right here that the Yankees do not score more runs if Kansas City is to stay in the hunt in this game.
Reggie has not made out tonight. He's 2-for-2, single, double, two walks.
Greg Nettles scored one of the Yankees' four runs back in the fifth inning. Throw to first. That's a good move, by Mingori.
Great
That's
move.
The best thing he has as a pitcher. A move to first.
Well, here's that situation again where you got a runner on first, you got the guy holding on, and I'm sure Greg is trying to hit the ball. Probably trying to hit it into the waterfall, but I know he's trying to pull the ball and take advantage of that hole.
Waterfall being the dancing waters here at Royal Stadium. It's a beautiful ballpark. Very pleasant place to visit and work.
If you're broadcasting.
Very high family attendance here. Greg Nettles swings right out from under his hat.
What's good pitch by Mingori. There he is, and he's hanging in there. Set the Yankees down in order in the sixth, the only inning in which that happened in this ballgame.
They have great fans here, Keith. I mean, this is the kind of place where you give up five or six runs and they applaud when you leave. I'm not sure if they appreciate your performance or you're just happy that you gave up the five or six runs.
Whatever makes you comfortable in Kansas City.
It happens to be a great city. Really a great city. It's alive. It's part of its time.
Two balls, two strikes now to the Yankee third baseman, Greg Nettles. Reggie Jackson is on first. He got a free pass. Chris Chambliss is on deck. Ball is full foul. I've got ball boy's moves out there. He's perfect on the night defensively. Yankees with four runs, 11 hits. They've left eight. Royals with one run, two hits. Finally broke through in the last inning. Another move to first. This time Reggie was closer. Not fiddling around with that good strong move to first by the left-hander. Wind is quiet. Temperature low 60s. Ball is lined to right. Base hit by Nettles. Cowens comes in, plays it on the bounce, throws quickly in there, and he looked like he might be trying to throw behind the runner, but the ball went into Patek instead, and Reggie's back.
Keith, that's one of Al Cowan's greatest talents. He has a marvelous throwing arm. He has a capacity for throwing behind the runner and frequently picks a runner off. But Jackson, tonight, is disproving something you once told me, Jim. Look at this. When you said he's a designated hitter, he's been playing a complete game. He moved in the early innings on a single and ran into second when Otis momentarily had trouble with a high bounce. So he showed his running capacity, and then he showed that he knew exactly what kind of player Cowens was in right field. Give him his mark, Jim.
You're great, Reggie. You're great.
Chris Chambers.
I hated to see him traded. I mean, he had two grand slams for me in 76.
Did he really?
Made my job easier. Plus, people come out to see him play. May not like him, but they come out to see him play or strike out or whatever.
There's a strike.
Throw back. Got Reggie picked off.
I take it all back.
Reggie slowed up. As you saw, he had no place to go because Greg Nettles was sitting on second base, having moved down there. It's a 2-6-5 pickoff.
Big play for the Royals. Watch Darryl Porter now.
I got to say this in defense of Reggie. It's the toughest base running play in baseball. He's trying to get a good jump. Chambliss is trying to bunt the ball, probably have the third baseman field it. And he bunted right through the ball. Reggie doesn't want to, you know, he doesn't want to get thrown out at third. That's not Reggie's fault.
No, you're
so
right.
You're partially right.
You're
what
right.
You said
you're
before.
Right.
All right, Chambliss stands in there now with one strike, having missed the bunt, and it's 1-1 as the pitch is high to him.
So it's now 12 hits for the Yankees and only 4 runs.
Yeah, but Nettles was heads up. He did get the second base.
That's
and
right.
He was in scoring position.
The left field, Braun coming in, makes the catch. 2 out.
Can't help think what you said, though. All these squandered opportunities.
Look,
score is still 4-1.
Really unbelievable. That's one story of the game. The other hidden story of the game. Well, there are two other stories. Beattie, in spite of wildness, containing Kansas City through 6 innings with help from Clay in the 6th. And then little Brian Doyle at second base with 2 hits and a key hit in an inning where the Yankees scored 2 runs.
Strike one, Roy White.
Well, that's it. I think all the good clubs, they have players that pick each other up. You got Willie Randolph out with it, indefinitely, I guess, with a pulled hamstring. And you have a guy that comes from nowhere to get 2 key hits.
And 2 excellent plays in the field.
1-1 for White.
Now this guy the Royals have to worry about. He is a better hitter right-handed than he is left-handed, though troublesome both ways.
Probably has a little bit more power left-handed, but this year he hit a lot better right-handed. I think he started out 4-for-50, he told me, from the left-hand side of the plate. That's why he didn't play early in the season.
Doug Bird remains in the Kansas City bullpen. Tomorrow night, they're going to put White on.
A little respect.
Smart move.
Tomorrow night, Larry Gura, 16-4 on the season. For Kansas City, Ed Figueroa, who won 20 this year, going to New York.
Tomorrow afternoon.
That's right. 3 o'clock Eastern Time, 2 o'clock in Kansas City. With 2 out now, the batter will be Brian Doyle. Doyle, 2-for-2, is knocked in a run. 2-for-3. First time up, he hit the ball sharply to Brett. George flagged it.
He makes contact.
Really does. Scrappy little fella.
Well, here's a player, perfect example of a guy knowing his limitations. It would be silly for him to stand up there and try to hit home runs. That's what his brother did. His brother had probably a little bit more power than him, Denny. And he was the same type of player. played against him when I hurt my arm in 68. And then with Boston and the Angels, he got the most out of his ability.
That's out of play. Two out, two on. Top of the seventh inning. Ball game has moved along at a deliberate pace.
Really has. The Yankees have left eight men on base. They don't score here, they will have left 10. That's a story, too.
A pitch high.
It's nice to have a guy hit 192 and then get two key hits in the playoffs.
Both starting pitchers are gone. Mingori relieving Leonard after four innings plus. Curve ball misses. Three balls and one strike now to Brian Doyle. Whitey Herzog is stomping around the dugout, wearing out that chewing gum.
You chew a little, you pull up the belt at the pants, tighten the windbreaker, and
one
pray.
One more line in the forehead. 3-1 pitch to Doyle. Dent's on deck. Ball is hit sharply foul.
I'll tell you, there is a lot of Eddie Stanky in that kid. He hangs in there. Swung out a little bit in front of it.
Well, Mingori had a 3-1 count. I think he realizes that if he walks Doyle, he's gone. They'll probably bring Bird in to face Dent. He's got to challenge the hitter.
Popped him up.
Got him.
Foul ground, Darryl Porter to catcher. The inning is over. So the Yankees threaten, but they pick the leadoff man off and then get the threat to pop up. It's 4-1 after 6.5. Inning.
There.
12 hits and only four runs is the reason for the conversation that's been running throughout this ball game on squandered opportunities. For Kansas City in the bottom of the seventh, it's Patek, White, and Braun against Ken Clay, a big 24-year-old right-hander. Clay just hums at home for strike one. Clay came on in the sixth inning relieving Beatty.
The impressive thing was he came on with confidence.
He's got two strikes on Freddie Patek. Spent part of July, in fact most of July, on the disabled list with a muscle problem in the chest area.
The Yankee management and scouting staff believes in this kid. He can throw hard. He showed enormous potential when he came up a couple of years back. Had an impressive outing against the Red Sox in a clutch situation. Then, unaccountably, was sidelined for a period of time and has struggled since.
He just struck out Patek.
Right now, he looks hot.
Well, it looks like he's throwing two types of fastball. He threw a couple sinkers. Got two strikes and then threw the fastball right by Freddie.
Yeah, but he threw it. You said that Freddie is a high fastball hitter.
Not that high.
Right in his eyes.
His figures against Kansas City in the past, as you looked at that graphic, were not impressive. But it's a new day every day in baseball.
Frank White, strike one.
Looks like Kansas City's taking the first pitch, trying to hope that he is going to become wild.
And Frank White is the leading first pitch hitter on the team.
That's hit in the air to the right side. Pinella coming over. He's got some room. He's got the ball. And you've got two out.
Earlier, I was talking about what Pinella was telling me about how he became not just a respectable outfielder, but a deceivingly efficient one. He gives all the credit to Bill Virdon, who was briefly the manager of the Yankees. And he said Bill had them hit flies to him for hours on end until he could have the instinct, the sense, of where the ball was going, where it would descend, where he could make the catch.
Ball one to the top man in the order, Steve Braun, leading off, playing left field. The crowd, 41,143, that is beyond capacity, and it's strike one. And Clay is just bringing it to him.
Beyond capacity? Have we violated the fire laws?
Yes. Two and one. According to the book they gave me, it seats 40,762. 3-1.
In a game like this, well, in any baseball game like this, there's a mounting, developing tension. The game means so much. And so the mere walk of Steve Braun creates a new situation, because at bat, one of the best hitters in all of baseball, Mr. George Brett.
Chuck Keller coaching at third, Minnesota Lonesome at third for Charlie tonight. Steve Boros is the coach at first base for Kansas City. And George Brett in the ball game is fouled out to the catcher, hit a fly ball to the right fielder and doubled and scored the only run. And he looks at a pitch that he does not like.
I thought it tailed in over.
I think he thought the ball was low.
I think so.
George got a pretty good eye, but might have been fooled on that pitch.
One strike. Ball one.
Nobody working in the Yankee bullpen. Peace and tranquility in the dugout.
Hit to Dent. Good play by Bucky. Second base.
They spend in spring training developing that kind of synchronization, Jim Palmer.
Well, Brett hits the ball sharp, likes the ball out of the plate. Bucky makes a nice play, but he can't get his feet under him, makes a flip.
And Ron Luciano makes the call. And after seven innings of play, Yankees 4, Royals 1. Back with more after this word from our local station.
And again, Friday afternoon from Yankee Stadium, when game number 3 will be played. All of the championship series action between the Yankees and the Royals right here as it happens on 11 Alive. Live on 11 Alive, Scooter.
All right. Boy, we were really alive tonight, Messer.
Yeah, really getting into this ball game.
All right, here he is. One of the big heroes in yesterday's ball game, Bucky Dent. And Bucky takes a strike. Bucky singled to drive in the first run of the ball game in the second inning. And he popped to first and bounced to short.
That is, this is one half of that keystone combination that sparkles.
One of my messes wound up, boy, I tell you. Top of the eighth inning. Foul back just below. One ball, two strikes.
Bucky Dent, I was talking to him before the game, Scooter, and he had sort of philosophical. He knew that if the Yankees had another infielder yesterday, he wouldn't have come to bat in that seventh inning. If he hadn't fouled a ball off his foot, he'd have stayed up there with a broken bat.
That's right. Bounces slowly, and Brett cuts across. Can't trouble getting it out of his glove, but just nips him. Bucky just could not put on the gas.
Here's that play again. He got it right off the end of the bat. Brett cutting in front of Patek. See there, he had to grab at it a couple of times, but he got him by a good step at first base.
All right, Mickey Rivers has fly to left, popped to short, single to right, and bounced to short. Ball one.
Well, Bucky Dent reminded me before the game that he was born in 1951, the year they had that classic playoff between the Giants and the Dodgers.
That's right. Foul off the end of the bat, 1-1.
He said he'd always heard about Bobby Thompson's home run in that one. And he said as a kid he dreamed of perhaps having a chance someday to do something similar.
No kidding.
And his chance came yesterday. Not as dramatic, because it was not a ninth inning shot, but it was just as important.
Oh, I'll say. Strike two. One ball, two strikes to Mickey. 30 years later, he had his dream fulfilled. Very patient to wait that long. And lined up base hit to right center. That could be X. Nope. That Collins can really get over there in a hurry. He's caught off a few potential doubles over there in right center field.
You know, the Royals play that way. They play the gaps out here, and you should, really. Ball down the line is going to be an extra base hit anyway. There it is again. The ball gets through there so fast. If you don't play over in the gap, that ball's going to get through for a double or a triple. So you concede the extra base hit down the line to the corner, but try to cut off those balls in the outfield in the gap.
Very well put, Mr. Messer. Here's Thurman Munson, who single to right, bounced to third, fly deep to left, and then bounced to third again. Yankees leading 4-1, top of the eighth. Throw to first, he's back. Boy, that was almost a bog. Gene Michael jumped about a foot off the ground. He almost stepped towards the plate and threw to first. Runner's going, and it's foul just below us. Mickey'll turn around and go back as the Yankees were trying to play hit and run.
Even though the Yankees have the 4-1 lead in this ball game, you don't want to see a club let down when he got a lead in the game. Just keep pushing it, because that becomes contagious. It carries over to the next game.
It does, and the Yankees have had 13 base hits and so far have left 10 men on base. Bouncer foul, Munson out in front, nothing in two.
I've seen teams with a lead late in the ball game, so, well, we've got this one won. Let's, it's sort of relax and wait for tomorrow. But you relax today, you may come out relaxed tomorrow too much. I use that word relaxed in a different context, of course, to do your best playing. We're going to get a pinch runner in here right now. Rivers may have hurt his leg on that last one, getting that jump. Rivers is limping a bit, and Paul Blair will go out there and run for him. Rivers has played much of the year with an injured leg. He sort of gritted his teeth on many occasions, gone out there and played anyway. On some occasions, he has not been able to go out there. But he evidently told Gene Michael that he hurt it. He comes out of the game for the pinch runner, Paul Blair.
All right, Blair, an excellent base runner, and as you all know, an excellent center fielder. The count on Munson, no balls, two strikes, one out. Here in the top of the eighth, the Yankees leading 4-1. Just missed the corner. One ball, two strikes. And Munson wants the umpire to look at the ball. He's going to throw it out of play.
Now, Ben Gorey very reluctant to give that baseball up. He knew it had a little scuff or a blemish on it. He wanted to keep that ball. Got him mad now.
That's good, because Thurman is mad right now. Foul back. Munson going after the high pitch. One ball, two strikes. Blair at first, LeCocq holding him on. It's been a very, very quiet crowd, except for one inning here for Kansas City. Throw to first. That time he did step towards first.
You get the feeling they transported that crowd from Boston out here to Kansas City. Did you ever see 30,000 people in such a state of shock?
No, I tell you, sad thing to see. Munson hits a high fly to shallow left. Coming in is Braun, the left fielder, and makes the catch for the second out.
I tell you, though, up there in Boston, as they reflect over the season and the 1978 Red Sox, I think people will realize they had an outstanding ball club that had a great year. True had a big lead, had injuries, lost the lead. Went well behind the Yankees late in the year, but then came back to force the playoff. They did an excellent job up there. I think Don Zimmer did a great job, and credit is due, certainly, to the Boston Red Sox manager, staff, and especially the players.
Right, and the fans have nothing to be ashamed of. They know that that whole team will be back next year. All right, Pinella, as the throw goes to first, Blair is back. Sweet Lewis bounced to second, fly to right, singled and scored, and bounced to short. Pinella played some baseball here for the Royals. Outside, ball one.
Enjoyed Rookie of the Year honors playing here in Kansas City.
Two men out. Yankees leading 4-1 in the eighth. As a base hit to left field, he hung that curveball and Braun had a leap to get that one. Almost went over his head. A bad throw, but backing up is Brett. Pinella gets his second base hit and the 14th of the ball game for the Yankees.
Buddy Herzog is on his way out. He wants Al Raboski out of the bullpen. Herzog has already made the motion before he came into camera range. He wants Al Raboski, the mad Hungarian, to come on here and pitch to Reggie Jackson. So, Whitey Herzog is out there to make a pitching change. Mingori leaves, and as we wait for Raboski to come on, we'll take timeout for this message. Raboski. During the regular season, he won 8, and he lost 7, and registered 20 saves in 58 appearances. Raboski had a brilliant career with the St. Louis Cardinals before coming over to the Kansas City Royals. 29 years old, born in Oakland, California. He led the Royals out of the bullpen and was fifth in the league with 20 saves. You look at his motion, his bread and butter pitch, a blazing fastball. Goes through many, many antics out on the mound, a period of meditation. That is an act with Raboski. He enjoys it. The fans enjoy it, especially here in Kansas City. I'm sure they did in St. Louis as well. Gets a little wearing sometimes on a broadcaster because he takes a lot of extra time out there between pitches. But he feels that it helps him. It doesn't add anything. He can do all the antics he wants. If he loses a little bit off that fastball, he can dig a hole out there at the mound and tunnel all the way to second base and pop up with a pumpkin on top of his head, and it wouldn't help him.
Yeah, here he goes into his act. I don't know whether they'll follow him, but Jackson's been red hot tonight. We'll watch Raboski, as Frank was telling you. Rub the ball up, meditate, then pound it into his glove and turn around quickly and about face. He's really milking this one, Frank. What's this?
He knows he's being seen everywhere. There it is, and there's the fan reaction to it. They love it out here in Kansas City.
The only thing is, when he makes the about face, he does it the wrong way. They'd get on him in the Marines for that.
That's because he's left-handed.
Oh, okay. All right, Reggie Jackson, a single, doubled, walked twice. Two out, two on. He tried to throw the fastball by him, and he did. A mad Hungarian, they call him. That one, Frank.
Hit a line drive. Home run over the 385 sign. Reggie, very gentlemanly about it, does not turn around and do a little meditating act of his own as he comes in. And now comes Miller time. When you've got the time to celebrate something special, head for the best tasting beer you can find, and that's Miller High Life.
Oh, man.
Did that ball go or not? You don't hit a ball any harder than that.
I said it, Jackson. He said.
Got to give him credit. Threw his best pitch, and Reggie hit it.
And it's 7-1 New York as Greg Nettles stands in. And he hits it out to left field for Braun. Steve drifts over, makes the catch, and the inning is over. But Al Raboski gets the call from the bullpen, comes in, and Reggie Jackson loses it at 385 feet. And it's lopsided. Yankees 7, Royals 1. Before the ball game, Reggie sat down for a moment and had a chat with Howard Cosell to talk about this first game in the championship series. Here's part of that conversation.
Reggie, in all the vicissitudes of your life with the Yankees, it's been clear that somehow you have the ability to rise to the occasion. And you proved it again yesterday. How do you come by this? What is there inside of you?
Well, Howard, I guess yesterday really was a convenient way of rising to the occasion, because at the time we had a 4-2 lead, and although there was some pressure involved, I just felt as though I had gotten us an insurance run with a home run, and it wound up being the game-winning home run. I was thinking of contributing to the ball club or to the win in some particular way. I try to be as reasonable, and I try to call on God as often as I possibly can, and just try to rely on Him. And for that, for me, that's my crutch, or that's my way of relaxing, and it seemed to have worked for me, and I want to try to stay with it.
Pre-game comments of Reggie Jackson, who has just nailed a three-run home run off Al Roboski to make it a 7-1 ball game. This is not the first time this year that Roboski has been stung into the home run. He has given up six in relief, five of them four three runs. This makes six for the season. Those others having been hit by Yastrzemski, Staub, Lamar Johnson, and Carney Lansford.
I gotta tell you, this is the worst time of the season for Roboski to have done that. You realize what this game means to the Yankees? If they can beat Dennis Leonard with Jim Beattie and Ken Clay,
it means they got to win tomorrow night or tomorrow afternoon.
Well, it means they walk out of here if they win it with no less than one out of two, which was all they wanted in the first place.
The pitch now to Amos Otis from Ken Clay for strike one.
Jim Beattie is the pitcher of record for the Yankees, and Dennis Leonard for Kansas City. It's 1-1 to Amos Otis.
Clay would be in a position to pick up a save if he finishes this game.
Foul out of play. One ball, two strikes. Yes, sir, you could call that from up here. Amos Otis caught looking. Kenny Clay's second strikeout.
The catcher, Darryl Porter.
And with one out, the batter will be Darryl Porter.
Tyson, this kid comes into his own. The Yankees are going to have another fine young pitcher on their staff. He has got a good arm, as we mentioned. He has matured quite a bit, and he has learned quite a bit. There's a great guy, Catfish Hunter, throwing out in the Yankee bullpen, getting some work in. Kenny Clay has said he's learned from just sitting around talking to Hunter.
Yeah, that could very well be. Strikes.
It will be Figueroa tomorrow afternoon, and Ron Guidry definitely on Friday afternoon back in New York. I think early in the telecast I mentioned Friday night. It is an afternoon game Friday, 3:30 New York time. Royals have only two base hits in this ball game. They both came off Jim Beattie. Got a no-hitter until the first batter in the fifth inning.
Lines it to center, Paul Blair digging, and Blair makes the catch. He made it look easy. I thought it was going to be a tough play, but he gets some jump on a ball.
He does. I don't believe I ever saw an outfielder get a better jump on a ball than Paul Blair. Always has. He had that God-given instinct. When he first came up with the Orioles, I saw him. He had that great instinct. He got that fine jump.
All right, here's Hal McRae, who has walked, fly to right, and hit a sacrifice fly. He has driven in the only run for the Royals and takes a strike. Two out here in the bottom of the eighth. Line, but Paul Blair with that good jump again and makes the catch. I tell you, you don't lose anything when you put him out there for Rivers. Nothing across at the end of eight. Yankees 7 and the Royals 1.
Pitcher to the Yankees here in the ninth inning, Doug Bird, a right-hander, will be on to pitch. They feel now, I'm sure, with the Yankees leading 7-1, they will save Roboski, will not use his arm anymore in this game. So they bring Doug Bird on to pitch. You know, Phil, we're talking about Paul Blair getting a great jump on the ball and the God-given ability to do it. Blair does another thing that I've never seen an outfielder do. He can be running for a ball full speed to the fence, catch the ball, and in one step, stop. It's just incredible. I've never seen reactions, really, as he has. Now, I'm going back 2 or 3 years now. He has not played that much over the last couple of years, but you still mentioned that jump he gets even without playing in ball games and sitting on the bench maybe a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks at a time. And coming in, he still has that great instinct that takes him to the ball.
Well, you're absolutely right, Frank, and you got to have it to do it the way he does, playing so infrequently. And who will ever forget that catch he made in Baltimore with his back to home plate, climbed the wall, made the catch as the ball was going over the fence with his back to home plate. Spun around, came down on the ground, never fell down. All right, Chris Chambliss has struck out twice, single to right, fly to left field. Chris has driven in one run. We're in the top of the ninth, and the Yankees lead it 7-1. A bouncer to his right, White. Flips to Patsek. Oh, a little cut the pie, but he's safe. He didn't have to do that. They must have been practicing that play. Uh-oh. We'll watch this again. Base hit.
There it is. There's White flipping to Patsek. Spun all the way around. I don't know.
No, Frank. You know, Jerry Pretty and I used to work that play, but only when one guy was so far off balance he couldn't throw to first. But White was cutting the pie there. And here is our Roy White, no relation to Frank White. And it's a balk. Was that a balk? He stumbled off the mound. No time was called by the home plate umpire.
Chambliss down at first base thought it might have been.
Yeah. But the plate umpire had called time. Roy takes the ball. White has doubled and scored. Bounced to second, popped to second and walked. Yankees with 16 base hits in the ballgame. Royals with only two. That'll be out of play. Back into the seats. 1-1.
Checking back of the 16 hits, there are 12 singles, two doubles, one triple, and one home run. Reggie Jackson's three-run homer. Jackson also had a double. White doubled, and Nettles has a triple.
Bounce slowly to LeCocq. He'll have to go back and touch first base, but moving to second is Chambliss as White is retired. Chris down at second base, and the batter, Brian Doyle. Doyle, line to third, single twice, and foul to the catcher. Yankees 7, Royals 1 in the top of the ninth. And one of the reasons, Frank Messer, the Yankees are winning, you know, my daughter Cindy is here tonight, wearing a Yankee cap. The only Yankee fan in one section.
Yeah.
Takes after the old man, Brave. Doesn't look like me, though. She looks like Cora.
Good for her.
All right, a bouncer back to Bird. They throw to third, and the ball is dropped. The ball is dropped, and Chambliss is safe. And going to second base on a heads-up play, Brian Doyle. Brett never had full control of that ball, Frank. It was just barely coming out of the glove when Chambliss' slide knocked it off the glove.
And Brett didn't know where the ball was. I think Brett thought he might still have had the ball. He didn't know where it was. The pitcher, Bird, ran over there and grabbed it finally, but not before Doyle had gone to second. Let's watch it again. Right back to the pitcher. I think it's a good play on Bird's part. But Brett never had control of it, and as Chambliss barreled in, they see the umpire at third base. Bill Kunkel looking around for the ball, sees it on the ground.
They have charged an error, I imagine, to Brett.
I didn't see anything wrong with the throw.
No, it didn't hit the ground. He should have had it. All right, Bucky Dent has singled, popped to first, bounced to short, and bounced to third. Now Bird wants to talk with Darryl Porter.
The fielder's choice, and an error charged on the play.
And now the Royals have to bring the infield in with runners at second and third and only one out. And the Yankees leading 7-1 in the ninth inning. Low ball one.
You know, Phil, you come out here to Kansas City, play two games, first two games of this playoff series. I think most teams would be happy to come out here and split.
Oh, yes.
Games.
You just want to win one. Hard grounder, but Brett's got it. And throws to first, pulls LeCocq off. Bucky slides, but he's out.
There again, that's the instinct to slide in. You get there quicker, really, I think, if you keep running.
Yep, you really do. You waste that fraction of a second sliding. Good play by Brett Chambliss, trying to bluff him and make it seem like he was coming home.
Watch it again on the replay. Brett's got the ball. You saw him take a look at Chambliss. Not a good throw to first base. Pulls LeCocq way off. Right there, Bucky loses just a little bit as he goes into the slot. I think he would have had him anyway.
All right, Paul Blair batting for the first time. He ran for Mickey Rivers. Paul pinch hit up in Boston, got a big base hit. Two out now and two on. Bounce foul. One and one. See who's coming up for the Royals in the bottom of the ninth. The bottom third of the order. Foul back in the seats, out of play. Nothing in two. Kansas City crowd. Trying to check his swing, fouled it off.
Bird out there during the regular season was used as a starter and reliever. He started six games, relieved 34 times, six wins, six losses, one save, a very high earned run average of 5.2.
Below us as Blair fouls it back onto the screen. Ball and two strikes, two out, two on. Yankees leading 7-1 in the top of the ninth. Strike three. Blair caught looking. The Yankees no runs, a base hit, an error, and two men left. And at the end of eight and a half, the Yankees 7, the Royals 1.
The Yankees had, there are a lot of ifs. If the Yankees had not had to play the game of the Red Sox yesterday, Beattie probably would not have had a start in the entire series.
It's true.
But here it is. Guidry had to start yesterday. Beattie forced into action tonight, and it looks like he will get a win in a series in which he was not really scheduled to start. You got a five-game series like this, usually you go with three pitchers. So maybe he would have, maybe he would not have. Beattie really the fourth pitcher in the Yankee rotation behind Guidry, Figueroa, and Hunter. So he would not, probably not have had a start. And speaking of starting, now is the time to start thinking about season tickets for the 1979 Yankee games. Be assured of the best seats for all the action next year by having your own full season or combination plan. For more information, simply call Group and Season Sales, area code 212-293-6000. That number again, 212-293-6000.
Leading off for Kansas City, the right fielder, Al Cowan.
Well, we see Cowan's coming up to bat, and Phil Clint Hurdle has come out on deck. He'll evidently bat for Patek.
All right, Whitey Herzog trying to get some men on base. Cowan's got the first hit off Jim Beattie as he tried to check his swing. Ball hit the bat and just sailed right on center field. And Kenny Clay's fastball over, strike one call. Curve line to left field, but Roy White is there, and Roy puts it away. Ball hit right on the nose, but White playing him perfectly. Clay takes a big sigh of relief out there. And now Clint Hurdle, as Frank told you, coming on.
Clint Hurdle batted 264 during the season. He had 110 base hits with seven home runs, 56 runs batted in. They thought so much of this rookie that they were willing to trade John Mayberry to Toronto to make room for Hurdle to play.
Ball one, a hurdle. Freddie Patek had a rough night. He popped to the pitcher and struck out twice.
Hurdle really didn't work out as their first baseman. They played him more in the outfield.
Foul out of play. It's one and one.
They have another pinch hitter on deck, Tom Poquet.
Two balls and a strike. And Kenny Clay wants a new baseball. There's Poquette on deck. He'll bat for Frank White. Strike two.
Somehow or other, I don't know, I think I'd bat him the other way around. I think I'd put Poquette up there ahead of Hurdle. Although you're down by six runs, you just need base runners. Hurdle's got the most power.
Uh-huh. Outside, full count on Clint Hurdle. One out, nobody on in the bottom of the ninth. That will be on the playing field, but nobody's going to reach it. Foul ball and bounces into the seats. Hurdle digging all the way around second, comes back. People might think this game would be an upset with the Yankees having to start Beattie, Frank, but can you imagine how revved up the Yankees were after defeating Boston up in Fenway Park?
Yes, they really were. Of course, their whole season rested on that one ball game played yesterday afternoon, and it was a well-played game, just an outstanding ball game.
High ball four. So Hurdle gets a base on balls. Third given up by Kenny Clay. And the batter, Tom Poquette.
Because the pitching the Yankees have received tonight from Beattie starting and Clay in relief, they've been able to save Gossage out there in the bullpen, give him the day's rest after an outstanding pitching job yesterday, but one of the most nervous pitching jobs I've seen.
And three tough innings for the Goose.
Yep, he got the Giants, had trouble with the nits and nats, but he got the big man when he had to.
One man out, strike one, a Poquette. Seven to one, the Yankees lead in the bottom of the ninth. Strike two. Poquette is crowding that plate, and he thinks the pitch is inside. But both pitches had quite a bit of the plate. High fly to deep right, but Pinella's got room. And Sweet Lou puts it away for the second out.
Now we talk about yesterday's ball game, and it was just a thrill to be there at Fenway Park. And I know it was quite a thrill for really millions of New Yorkers who watched the ball game on television. I understand it was just the audience in New York was just tremendous for the game yesterday. And I tell you, the New York fans really behind this Yankee ball club.
Oh, boy. A lot of them flew up to just to see that game. Bounce it a second. This could do it. Brian Doyle flips to Chambliss, and the ball game is over. A big, big win for the New York Yankees. The final score of the Yankees, 7, and the Royals, 1.
Ryan Doyle threw out Steve Braun for the first out in the ball game, and he threw him out for the last out. In between, the Royals managed only two base hits. They scored one run. They did receive eight walks from Yankee pitchers, five from winning pitcher Jim Beattie, and three from Kenny Clay, who got a save in this pivotal first game of the series. The Yankees, 7 runs, 16 hits and no errors. The Royals, 1 run, 2 hits and 2 errors. Reggie Jackson led the Yankee attack with a single, a double, a 3-run homer, and the Yankees just completely overpowered the Royals tonight. One team came to play and the other one didn't. That's what it boils down to. The Yankees came to play, as Bill White mentioned early in our telecast tonight. After watching the Royals in pregame workouts, he felt that they were uptight. And I think they showed it on the field defensively in the first inning when they did not turn a double play that they should have. Also, when an error was committed out in center field by Otis, the Royals were not swinging the bat well. The Yankees won the ball game 7-1, and now we'll have Ed Figueroa going tomorrow afternoon against Larry Gura, and we'll have it all for you right here at 3 o'clock. Final score, Frank Musser here for Phil Rizzuto and Bill White. The final score, the Yankees 7, the Royals 1.